morning and welcome to the third meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2024. Before we begin, can I ask anybody using an electronic device to please switch it to silent? Our first item of business this morning is to decide whether to take item 4 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. We now have our fourth and final round table on the Agriculture and Rural Communities Scotland Bill. Today's evidence session will focus on enabling rural communities to thrive, which is one of the objectives of the bill, and we'll also have the opportunity to discuss the bill more broadly. We have up to 3 hours scheduled for this discussion, and a welcome to the meeting, in no particular order. Douglas Bell, the Managing Director of Scottish Tenant Farmers Association. John McCulloch, the Chair of the Agri and Rural Affairs Committee from the Scottish Association of Young Farmers. Theon Morrison, the Chair of Scottish Rural Action. Professor Stephen Thompson is a Professor of Agricultural Economics and Policy at SRUC. We've got Grant Moyer, the Chief Exec from the Cairngorms National Park Authority. Jerry Moody, the Secretary and Advisor from the Central Association of Agriculture Valuers in Scotland. Professor Sarah Skerritt, the Chief Executive of the Royal Society of Edinburgh. And Rob Clark, the Head of Policy from Highlands and Islands Enterprise. We've received apologies from Dr. Bob McIntosh from the Scottish Land Commission, who's sadly unable to join us today. So, we have, as you've just heard, we have quite a few participants this morning, so if I can ask everybody to keep their questions and answers as succinct as possible. And if you just raise your hand, I'll spot you, or one of the clerks will bring you into the discussion. If a point has already been made, rather than repeat your support of that, if you just indicate that you agree or disagree and we can move on to the next contribution, that would be helpful. So I'm going to kick off with the first question. It's just a very broad question on the views on the objective of enabling rural communities to thrive and your views on how the sustainability of rural communities and the wider rural communities can be supported through the development of this new agricultural policy and how you foresee that objective being delivered. Who would like to kick off? Stephen Thompson.
Thanks. I suppose for me there's two elements to that question, and the first element is the role that agriculture plays in the wider rural economy. And we have to consider that for some localities, some very small localities and regions, but also at some local authority levels, then agriculture is a big contributor not only to GVA but to business turnover, business count, etc., etc. So the sector does have a very important role in some parts of rural Scotland. And then you've got the associated multiplier effects upstream into the supply chain and then downstream into the processing and food and drink sector. The thing that people quite often assume is that all of the processing is done in rural areas. It's not. It's quite often done in peri-urban areas. So we need to consider those kind of urban-rural linkages as well. So the bill enabling farmers to be paid and supported is important for those economies. The wider rural community bit is how important is agriculture to these areas, and then the community-led local development element, the LEADER, formerly known as LEADER. And that bit is, to me, is a bit unclear because I don't know how much budget is going to be spent on it. I don't really know what the provisions of the bill are trying to do because it seems all-encompassing. But the general feel is right, is that it will support continued economic activity in rural areas.
Douglas Bell.
Yeah, I agree with Stephen. I think you would expect me to push home the role that farmers play in the economies of rural areas. We would describe them as a cornerstone. So totally agree with Stephen in that. I think there is potential as the secondary legislation comes to put measures in place which support rural communities, without a doubt.
Thank you. Fiona.
So just speaking, I suppose, as a crofter as well, but I would just turn it around and say, I think without rural communities, you wouldn't really have an agricultural landscape, that you need people. And I think if all of us reflect on why we choose to live in a place, it is all those things that support our lives separate from our working life that we need. So it's our primary school, it's our medical care, it's our shop, it's our pub, it's our church, it's our sports activities, it's all of those things. And if you think how rural and island areas are underpinned by social enterprises delivering a lot of those things, and community-led local development has enabled a lot of that to flourish, then I think we need to recognise that for me, who absolutely believes that agriculture is about feeding the people of Scotland, and we should be able to do that, but in order to do that, people delivering on agriculture, given the average age of farmers is 59 and maybe crofters 120, we do need to support the rural communities, the lights on in all those communities, so that folk don't need to travel to cities for anything that they require.
Rob Clark.
Yeah, I agree with comments thus far. I think my point is around the fact that rural communities are, they're more than just about agriculture and crofting, important though that is. So we have people in rural communities who are doing many other different things. We have people who are running businesses, working in creative industries and the like. And I think I'm very heartened that the bill has the breadth, as it's currently written, to support these areas. I guess the devil will be in the detail about how much the focus is on agriculture and land management as opposed to wider rural development. And I think wider rural development is really critically important and shouldn't be lost as we get into the detail of the specific support that's going to be provided.
Okay, thank you. I've got Grant and then Sarah.
Yeah, I mean, just to follow up on some of those points, but I think the fact that the rural economy and the agricultural side are obviously intertwined together, I think what we've got to look at is how much we support that wider rural economy within the overall budget allocations within the bill eventually. One of the key things around that is if you look at something like the Cairngorms economy, but 60% of the total economy is tourism. So that's a big factor within the Cairngorms. Now, a lot of that relies on work that land managers do within that area as well. So you can't separate these things out in terms of saying agriculture here, rural economy there, communities there. I think it's trying to say how do we integrate these things together and look at what the best balance of funding is to make sure that we're supporting economic activity that really delivers for Scotland.
Okay, thank you. Yes, certainly. Jim.
Just on that point, Grant, are you suggesting, therefore, that the agricultural bill gets split between agriculture and tourism, or should any funding for tourism come from a separate pot?
No, I don't think it should be split, but I think when you look at things like the community-led local development, if you look at some of the stuff we support in terms of wider economic development, that is stuff that is already supported within the overall approach that we do at the moment. So you look at what used to be leader funding within the Cairngorms, it's now CLLD. That supports a whole range of things across the wider rural economy. I think that's a good thing, alongside the work that goes into the land management side. I just think it's about saying, how do we make sure that we're doing the right things in the right places and make sure that the bill does cover off that wider approach, which is in there in the bill. It does cover off all these different things. I suppose the question is, what are the proportions associated with these?
OK, thank you.
Rachel Hamilton's got a further supplementary on that.
I'm interested when the responses have been connected to things that are out with agriculture, but the A&M group made the point that the core agricultural activity is integral to supporting rural communities. So their comment around the contraction of the Sutcliffe beef herd is important because so many jobs rely on that. And I just wondered if Jeremy perhaps had a comment around that relationship between that rural communities and core agricultural activity.
Well, thanks very much. I'm finding, for the tensions that have been in the remarks so far, I'm finding this quite a challenging objective among the other objectives here, and trying to understand a little, perhaps, a question in my mind as to how far this is here, if I put it possibly over simply, for show or for meaning. It touches on, if you like, a missing statement in the objectives, which is about the productivity and resilience of agriculture itself. And I think that's a point to come back to, that we are to look at agriculture as part of thriving, a thriving economy, rural communities and others, then that, I think, is an important goal that is picked up in other legislation elsewhere in other parts of the United Kingdom, but not at the moment on the face of the bill. And so I think that perhaps is a bit that's missing. Clearly, there are interconnections over particularly over landscape, and we learnt this brutally with Foot and Mouth, that firstly, tourism was the bigger generator in many rural areas, but secondly, it relied on the landscape the farming produced, and a lot of lessons came out of that experience 20-odd years ago. But we're watching farming populations. They have shrunk. The labour force has shrunk. Very often, they are, because of the nature of the work they do and where they're located, very often they're now less involved in communities than they were in many areas. You know, the activity in community life in many areas will now... some areas, they will actually be the residual part of the historic local population and all the connections and so on that go with that. And that makes this quite challenging when thinking about how this relates with the objective of thriving rural communities and what this is about. And some of this I see as a hangover from the Rural Development Regulation being picked up in here. And I could think there's enough pressure on the budget to deal with the agricultural parts of this rather than adding in an objective here. I think there's some really quite serious tensions around this that I'm pleased you're touching on and exploring. But quite clearly, if you can manage profitable suckler beef production, then that generates jobs, it generates the downstream jobs, A&M's markets, among other things, and you know, that is then clearly good. But it comes back to that question of profitability, productivity improvement, competitiveness, sound businesses. And I think that's an understated but fundamental objective to achieving the other goals.
Opening comments and then supplements from Ariane and Rhoda.
Thank you, and thank you for the invitation today. I think already, as you've used the word tension, I'd like to follow up on that and talking about adding in items. When we're talking about the term you used around enabling rural communities to thrive, looking at definitions that have been used to date, it's defined as assisting people to live, work or operate in rural areas, invest in infrastructure and services for rural areas, assisting people to produce strategies for rural development. And traditionally, this has had a budget allocation of 5% of the 30%, and now it's 5% of 25%. So it's often the bridesmaid, you know, and that amount is getting smaller. And so defining rural communities is absolutely critical. And from my perspective, there's a danger of conflating rural communities within the agricultural definition. And already we're seeing this in the discussion. Mm-hmm. So there's real importance in defining and raising the profile of that diversity of rural communities. Mm-hmm. Secondly, there's a need to use the data that we already have. LEADER and its successors have been in existence since 1991. So when you're asking how do we do this through the bill, we have a wealth of data. And I believe those data are not being mined sufficiently. And we're in danger of being inefficient because there's so much learning, so many evaluation reports from LEADER and even the successors in recent years, reports produced in 21, 22, 23, on the learning from LEADER and its very recent successes. And we need to use those in order to make the most of the small budget allocation that is going to see LLD through the lags. And this is even more important because those budget allocations are, I think, in the majority going through local authority arrangements, which are more naturally risk averse in the current climate. And that will allow for systematic change rather than piecemeal change, which is the focus of many lags.
Thank you. Before I go to members, I'm going to bring John in to give us the perspective of the young farmers.
I think from a young farmer's point of view, I think we're seeing more and more across the whole of Scotland when it comes to the community side of it, clubs getting involved in community projects, and it seems to be the first thing that communities turn to is the Young Farmers Club. And I think that, in a way, is quite telling in my mind of that is, you know, going back to probably quite an old-fashioned thing, but the fact that communities turn back to the farmers to do projects and stuff like that, whether it be, you know, I think some instances gardening and care homes and stuff like that. I think, you know, communities are very important. We are very aware of it. I think probably more so in Dumfries and Galloway. We see a lot of clubs getting involved in projects in the community, maybe not so much so in Central Belt, but the same in the North region as well. So I think communities, as much as, you know, this bill should focus primarily on the agricultural side of it, I think communities have to be a huge part of it as well.
Ariane.
Thanks, Peter. So continuing this, and Sarah, I hear the importance of that 5% or 25%. So the James Hutton Institute in our papers is quoted as saying that support for agriculture is the most effective or efficient questions whether support for agriculture is the most effective or efficient way to address issues facing rural areas. As such, the bill provides a foundation for agriculture and environmental policy, not rural policy, more widely. And we see that there's lots of opportunities now, community ownership, community woodlands, community renewables, nature restoration projects, and soft infrastructure that we desperately need through training and for facilitation. So I just wonder if the agricultural budget is the most important or appropriate source for funding for rural communities, if we're going to get clear around, yes, there's an agricultural farming community, but there's a wider community, there is an interconnection, but do we need to be looking at the support payments coming for agriculture and growing food, and then other ways, like also another opportunity coming is the Community Wealth Building Bill, and how do we make that work for communities? And of course, I hear from the LAGs, the local action groups, how important that money is and how transformative it is, that 5%. So, but I'm just wondering if we could look at how we do that differently. So maybe I'll go to you, Sarah, but I think also maybe Rob Clark from HIE. For a start.
Yes, Sarah.
So I'm not wanting to put resources in opposition to one another, nor objectives. My sense is that there is a need to be clear about those objectives and not assume the outcomes of one will be achieved through putting money to another. And that is the evidence from years of delivering LEADER and working through LAGs. So the sentence that I read out to you is from the CAP arrangements that are being observed on an interim basis ahead of 2025, and those are far-reaching, and the evidence would suggest that those cannot be wholly achieved through resources coming through an agricultural-only route, and that if certain outcomes, given these outcomes, not if, given these outcomes are to be achieved for rural communities with their wider set of businesses and entrepreneurial routes and the very real needs that are observed, hence an Islands Act, hence discussion of impact assessment relating to islands and also wider rural communities. There's a recognition there, there's an evidence base there. The Hutton database, the Hutton data you talk about, SRUC's research as well, show that there are particular characteristics of wider rural communities that are different from those observed in farming communities. So the evidence shows that to actually try and achieve objectives for one cohort of the population through monies diverted to another is not a rational way of going about things, or an efficient way of going about things, particularly when the monies are so constrained. So to me, it's about looking at the evidence of what works well, and we've got 30 plus years of that, and saying, given that, how should these monies be addressed to these particular objectives for this cohort of the population? Not dividing them, as John said, the young farmers are very involved, as one example, but saying what's the most efficient way to spend these limited resources.
Thanks.
And then Jeremy.
Yeah, I think one of the things that's worth thinking about, though, is how much each of these different areas underpins each other. So if you've got, I mean, I'm just looking through what we've supported through the community-led local development plan over the past couple of years. Now you look at things like pathways for rural employment get supported through LEADER, trying to get people into rural work. You look at things like there was support for venison branding, that side of things. There's lots of things that underpin on the agriculture side. And then on the agriculture side, if you're looking at things where people are doing work to prevent, let's say, flooding off a village or things like that, they're both interacting with each other. It's very, I think, trying to put arbitrary lines sometimes between rural and agriculture, it sort of works for policy to an extent, but actually how they then actually interact on the ground, you need to have these things happening together, because you need, it can't be one thing or the other. So I do think that having something like the CLLD defunding within the package is a good thing. I think what we need to say is that that thriving rural communities thing isn't just linked to that one objective or that one fund within it. There are things you can do through the agriculture side that do support thriving communities. It might be slightly at one remove, but it's still money that if you're putting into land management that does things that benefits communities, whether that be clean water, whether, you know, whatever it might be. But there's a whole lot of benefits that come out of that I think you could attach to thriving rural communities that still payments to land management.
Okay. Jeremy.
Yes, thanks. I think this is an instance of a rather more strategic question, which is that I look at the vision and see something really quite radical and driving with major change, and it uses cultural change, it uses transformation and the like. And there's something about this part of the discussion which is more about working from where we have been. And I think there might be a need to look more about where it is we're trying to go, looking at the climate change objective, the other goals and pressures, and indeed my concerns about productivity. And this almost seems to sit in the bill as legacy of past policies. Therefore, it's here as an impression of the past. Mm. And actually, if you're trying to run a rational strategy for the future, all the objectives interconnect, of course they do, but this might not be the right place to provide for that objective. And that's a question I think I would leave with you out of this discussion, but more generally about the whole approach to unfolding agricultural policy in this. Is this evolving out of what we have, or is this now Scotland's chance to look at what it wants and where it wants to go for the future?
Stephen.
Yeah, just picking up on Jeremy's point, I mean, it is a legacy of the European Agricultural Fund for Rural Development, which quite often people considered the rural development policy for Scotland, where it's a tiny, tiny proportion of the total budget that's spent, government budget that's spent on rural development. If you think about health, transport, housing, all of the things that go into these areas, this was a means of trying to demonstrate how that agricultural budget can help facilitate things like farm diversity. We in UK and in Scotland went down a totally different route than other countries in LEADER, and quite often they were supporting more agricultural rural development, integrating on farm diversification, whereas we went down a much more community-based approach to LEADER. So it is a real legacy of that. Everybody's kind of forgotten that the real-term budget cuts that agricultural has seen in Scotland are quite astounding. So if you look back, so I did some numbers using the agricultural input data from DEFRA, and basically your purchasing power has more than halved in the last 20 years. So we're stretching this budget further and further. And then, you know, what can we realistically deliver? And what is the principal objectives of an agricultural bill and agricultural and rural communities? We're kind of into this mixed understanding of what the purpose of the bill is for. And you've got things like the Levelling Up Fund. You've got the city and region deals. We're starting to see things like healthcare doing more CLLD-type approaches. So we're starting to see the approach that the government seemed to be putting in this bill here happening more often, more and more, in that communities are having a say as to how the services are being delivered for them. The Community Wealth Bill was mentioned, or Community Wealth Building was mentioned. All of this needs to be coherent and structured, and I was just, it always strikes me that the rural delivery plan that the First Minister announced, cross directorate delivery, is the thing where we need to better understand where this sits, because currently it appears as a legacy.
Douglas.
Yeah, I think just picking up on that point that Stephen made about the erosion of the purchasing power of the support that farmers receive. One of the things I was you know, disappointed to see in the objectives of the bill is, you know, that maintaining fair incomes for farmers. That's one of the objectives of the cap going forward, and it has been since its inception. I think that in terms of that maintaining rural communities, maintaining those incomes on farms should be an objective, you know, front and centre. I appreciate all the pressures on budget and everything else and the ambition of the rural development policy, but clearly I feel there's a gap there that in terms of objective.
I've got a few members have got their hands up. Rhoda was first, and then Karen, and then Alistair.
It seems to me we're speaking about things that should be funded from other budgets that the bill doesn't really talk about. But I wonder, taking it back to the bill, because that's what we're looking at, is there anything we can put in the bill to ensure fairer funding for rural areas? Because lots of the things we're talking about today, if we're talking about an urban area, they would be coming from a different pot, not from this pot. So is there anything we can do with this bill to make sure there's fairer funding from other pots for rural areas, rather than trying to carve up this amount of money between competing real needs in rural communities?
No.
I was just nodding then. That's like bidding in a... I agree. I mean, it comes back to Stevie's point about, I think... Sorry, I might be putting words into your mouth, but about this coherence between policies, and we've been looking at the National Planning Framework as well, and the rural revitalisation and elements in there. And this isn't really answering your question, sorry, Rhoda, but about what other elements are in play, and where should resources be pulled from those other elements, and how should this bill refer to those other elements in order to cross-reference or ensure cross-reference and ensure resource drawdown from those other elements? Because if we're saying that there's so much pressure on this and the emphasis needs to be on agriculture, where is the unmet need and where is the pump priming to support the energy in rural communities if it's not going to come from here? Where else in the system is it going to come from?
Okay. Yeah, if somebody wanted to just cover that question there. So I've got Stephen.
Like just specifically for Rhoda's point, for me, that's what the rural support plan should be highlighting. So, you know, if we're truly going to have a rural support plan, then it needs to be in there what the risks are, what the benefits of spending the money in these areas are. And until we actually see that, then it's challenging. And that's where the CAP strategic planning framework and the requirement for member states to deliver on a CAP strategic plan that's signed off by the Commission has been so powerful, because the Commission have a say and oversight of that. But to me, the bit, and I suppose it comes back to the bit that Sarah was mentioning, is there is a real risk that if you take this out of the bill, then it falls through the gaps. And that it just disappears and it won't happen. No one will pick it up. So there has to be a statutory requirement to ensure that this type of activity continues. Where it sits, that's for others to determine. But I mean, it is a really important part that if it's not funded here and it's not in this bill, where will it sit and how will it get supported?
I've got John and Jeremy. I want to add a little bit to that question. You maybe consider when your response is, you talked about the plan. Now, the DPLR committee recommended that the five-year plan was published prior to stage three of this bill. Is that something that you think is essential before we come to the secondary legislation that we're inevitably seeing about this framework bill?
Is that directed at me?
Yes. John and Jeremy.
In SRUC's response, I think we were pretty clear that the rural support plan needs to be front and centre. And actually, I would go beyond just presenting it to Parliament. I would give Parliament power to scrutinise it and also have annual updates, an annual scrutiny of it. Because otherwise, you have support our government support that's unscrutinised. And if you think about the European Union and we're, if we still have ambitions to align to EU, the EU have that, or the Commission have that oversight role. And then you've got the Court of Auditors have another oversight role. So you know, the member states are being held to account on how they're spending that money. And there is a risk that the rural support plan is just a set of nice words.
OK. I've got John, Jeremy, Fiona and Douglas.
OK. From a young farmer's point of view, I think there is an extreme lack of talk of how young people are going to be helped either into the industry or either to own their own farms and farm in their own right, or young people coming into the industry to work in agriculture. I know there's a part in the bill about talking about training and CPD. You know, a lot of employers don't have the funding to put, you know, young employees through the training that they require, and, you know, will need support to do that. And I know there's limited grants available, but, you know, if there was a potential way of extending those grants or helping maybe put more grants in place, you know, I think that's something that the bill should cover a bit more.
Thank you. Jeremy.
I think there's a point here that perhaps we've lost sight of during the years in the CAP, but was clearly there in the old Agriculture Act and is sitting there in all the agricultural legislation that's coming forward now across the UK, which is that agricultural policy is about more than payments. In a sense, we lapsed into thinking about it once intervention money was crystallised into support for production and then support for land occupation. And you know, picking up on the point just made now, the issue being picked up in parts of the Land Reform Bill over tenancy legislation and how you might enable more opportunities for lettings is critical, and it was there in 48 and structures around that, other areas of policy. So it may be, to come back to the underlying question, it may be that regard is had to the needs of thriving rural communities, that it shapes the policies that are coming through, but this is an agricultural bill for agricultural policies tempered by that, so it's stated in the bill, but not necessarily an object of expenditure.
Theon, and then Douglas.
Well, I was just going to pick up on what John was saying there in terms of how the rural diaspora, if you like, articulates with succession planning for the agricultural landscape. So just one very small example was when we introduced the crofting bill to stem population decline and recognising its economic importance within the Western Isles. We now see the impact of that with, just as an example, the average age profile of the Agricultural Committee being a generation younger than it was 10 years ago. So directly investing in those skills that were appropriate to crofting, but it could be any other sector in your locality, then you've got that place-based knowledge and understanding that is relevant to the economy where you are. And if that is in agriculture, then so be it. But it's part of the pie chart of understanding your local economy within which everything sits, tourism, agriculture and everything else. I also said, picking up on Jeremy's point about the vision, I think that's correct, but this bill should also articulate, of course, with the Good Food Nation Bill. And in that context, where we should see more local procurement, that will also impact those on those producing the food. If local authorities are going to be using local food in education, in public sector, you know, health sector, in hospitality, in prisons or wherever it is. So that will impact the way farming delivers the food that is going to be used in our nation. But they do articulate together, and recognising that they're not separate entities is really important, I think.
Thank you. Douglas, then Karen, supplementary.
Convener, just coming back to your point about the timing of the rural support plan, totally endorse what's been said already, that the earlier that can come, the better. There is a real frustration amongst agricultural stakeholders just now about working in a vacuum, and I think if the more we can see up front, including the code of practice on sustainable and regenerative agriculture, the support plan, that's going to help thinking and hopefully, you know, taking a meaningful part of the co-designing and co-development process.
Thank you. We're going to come to with further questions on the rural support plan from Rachel Hamilton a little bit later. Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. We've seen some fantastic examples as a committee and myself as a constituency MSP of diversification on farms, particularly in agritourism. Often, I must say, really driven by the female force on the farms, and they do help support rural communities to thrive. We've seen some fantastic examples of employment opportunities for local young people in these environments. Do you think this is something that should be considered amongst this? This is something that is very much tied to the agricultural side of things within itself.
Stephen.
As somebody that dealt with farm diversification advice for a long, long time, there's two schools of thought on this, and I suppose one school of thought is that if you are diversifying a business and starting up in a non-agricultural sector, why would you not go through the usual business startup routes or the business support routes through the business gateway, through the local enterprise company or the enterprise network? And the alternative is that agriculture is this thing that stands alone and has got unique circumstances and it's difficult. And where farm diversification sits is a real challenge, because you're right, it's a bit that we don't really understand the value to the economy of those diversified activities, quite often because once they're successful, the business structure is that it becomes a separate business entity. So it's no longer associated with the farm. It just happens to be located on the farm. So those are really important elements. And I suppose the CLLD funding or leader funding has supported farm diversification in the recent rounds. Previously, there was dedicated funding for farm diversification within the rural development programmes, within Objective 1, within Objective 5B. So there was always this support element for farm diversification. But I can also see the argument that it should sit with the wider business structures.
Just a quick postscript to that, if I may, around women and young people. Certainly the aspirations within the CAP at the moment, at the risk of looking backwards, around inclusion aspects, and that there is merit in measures which explicitly aim to include women and young people in particular in measures and looking at how to do that. Additionally, the Hutton report recently, which evaluated CLLD, talked about burnout and capacity issues in rural communities. So moving on from your diversification point to wider rural and the need for succession planning within rural communities to engage with the opportunities that are offered through funding and through other mechanisms. Mm-hmm. So for inclusion reasons and succession planning, it's important that these are not only thought about but actually made explicit within legislation from an evidence point of view.
Douglas.
Yeah, I think with the background in terms of diversification might change a little bit in terms of delivering for climate change and for biodiversity loss. One of the things that STFA is lobbying hard is to make sure that tenants have equal opportunity to those diversifications. And until, in terms of the consultations on this bill, modernisation of agricultural tenancies was part of the bill. It's now not. It's been moved across to the Land Reform Bill. But it's still very important that tenant farmers have the same capacity to diversify, whether that's into agri-environment type diversifications or more tourism-based diversification. We are lobbying really hard that the timing has to be right. So as these measures are designed under this, the secondary legislation for this bill, we need to make sure that the Land Reform Bill allows tenants to participate as well. So just to make that point, Carmen, you mentioned diversification. We've got a real issue that we need that to be pushed through, albeit out with the scope of this bill.
Stephen's got a comment on that.
It's not to pick up on Douglas, but it's the diversification into agri-environment and or climate mitigation. These are things that are getting mainstreamed into agricultural policy, so it shouldn't be seen as standalone as diversification. You know, these will be part of the daily life of farmers going and crofters going forward, and wider land managers. The key thing in the Just Transition Commission, when we were taking evidence in up in Granton, was, and I think that I don't like to speak for the whole commission, but people were taken and really concerned about the challenges that the tenanted and rented sectors, the crofters, will have in delivering against all of the objectives that government want in terms of climate change and or biodiversity gain as we move forward. So I totally agree with that part, but remember, it's not diversifying, it's mainstreaming these objectives.
I'm going to bring Alistair for a supplementary.
Thank you. I'm just thinking back to something that Sarah, you mentioned earlier on about making sure that the objectives of support for communities align with the support for practitioners of agriculture, and how the two aren't quite the same thing. It just occurred to me, I don't know if the crofters in the room want to make any comment about this, but there is something distinctive about crofting where you have a whole community, not a whole community, but a big slice of a community that is engaged in agriculture compared to most rural communities. So I just wonder if there's anything anyone want to say about what might be different about that relationship in the funding model when it applies to crofting. Or should be different.
Maybe, if I'm the only crofter in the room. but, I mean, crofting, as you know, I mean, historically when they were set up, it was set up so that the crofter still had to work for the landowner. We're in a slightly different place today, although not exclusively in all areas. But crofting is part of a pluralistic economy. Therefore, it sits alongside other modes of employment. And therefore, by virtue of just saying that, then that's going to be part of a wider rural community.
Any other comments? Stephen.
We've recently been commissioned to do some work by the local action groups in Orkney, Shetland and Western Isles. And one of the key things that we're looking at is the difference between farming, PLC, and crofting. And trying to disaggregate and disentangle how this bill and future support will impact on crofting areas. In that you've got lots of small farmers or small crofters, small users, who may be in receipt of very small sums of money, who may be disenfranchised by having to meet a whole raft of entry-level conditions, and that these conditions, meeting those conditions, will exceed the support levels they get. So they may fall out of the system. So there's a real need to really think carefully about the entry-level conditions and the disproportionate costs of entry for smallholders and crofters. For me, there still remains unanswered questions as to how all of this pans out on common grazings. So in the bill structure, it talks about conditionality. How are we going to do that when there may be only two or three active crofters on a common grazing? But equally so, in the research that we're doing, we're starting to hear stories about communities that were maybe only two active crofters and the community was dying. And then suddenly in the last few years, you've had a huge influx of new people into the area who are all actively crofting. And you know, it's got a real opportunity to help communities thrive and local areas thrive.
We've got a couple of more questions on the theme of the objectives in this policy. I just want you to consider whether, and I think the discussion it points in that direction, that whether we need more definition around the objectives that are on the face of the bill, but also whether there needs to be further objectives, because we know the European legislation has more objectives. Do we need more, and do we need the ones that we've got to be defined more fully? Who would like to have a go at that? Grant.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose my worry is if you start just putting in lots more objectives, you end up covering anything and everything, and that you have a bill that then has objectives to, in effect, sort everything in it, and it's not aimed at that, it's aimed at certain things. So I think the point about making sure that there's real clarity about what those objectives are really about is really key. So, you know, when you say thriving rural communities, what do you really mean by that? And when you're looking at other things like production of high-quality food, what do you really mean by that? I think that's really key in terms of defining that very carefully. I'm not sure just adding in more objectives to cover other things particularly helps, because I just think you'll end up with it spreading out. And I suppose just to go back on just the very thing, I think one of the things I think is interesting about the CLLD part that I think is worth thinking about is a small part of the budget, but it does lever in a lot of other money, which on top of that, so if you look at just in terms of the lag that I'm involved in the past 2 years, yes, there were £630,000 of funding put through that, but the total projects were 1.1 million. So there's money that gets levered in, and I can't think of many community projects throughout Scotland that don't have some form of leader slash CLLD funding in that. And I think it's really important to know if you've got thriving rural communities, and if it's not part of this bill, you would lose an awful lot if it isn't somewhere else. So I think it's really crucial that we know that wider rural development funding is part of this. And if you have a rural support plan, it really needs to define exactly what that is.
So you're, in effect, your response is that we've got the right number of objectives on the face of the bill, but those objectives need to be clearer and more broadly defined.
I think people need to know exactly what it is they mean, because what I might define as thriving rural communities might be entirely different what Stephen defines as thriving rural communities versus, and I think sometimes that's where a few years down the line you start to get into all these questions about, well, was that what we meant at the time? And I think we've got to be really clear about it up front.
Jeremy and then John. Douglas.
If this is to be a bill or an act with a life of more than 5 or so years, it needs to be very broadly framed. It needs to have its objectives really quite openly cast. The risk of being too specific is we'll be back here in 5 years' time looking at what we've done. We'll inevitably learn by doing. You go back to the model of the 48 Act. That stood really till 73. And if we can manage a generation's worth of legislation, we'll have done quite well in this. At that point, then, we can all play with words, and playing with words in committee is one of the most lethal trades known to man. But I would suggest, looking at this, that, regenerative, there is considerable dispute as to what that actually means, whether it's about process or outcomes and so on, and obviously the code can define some of that. But it's been a theme that's emerged in the last 10 years, and it might go. We might find other concepts. Sustainable seems probably to be more sustainable, more lasting, but profitable, productive, profitable, I think would be a good goal. And I think put sustainable and profitable probably together. High quality food has been mentioned. I don't think anybody's going to argue for low quality food. So but it obviously ties in with legislation. Climate mitigation and adaptation, absolutely. And I think then the issues around nature, whether restoration is a useful word, because to what, when? We are actually looking with climate change at major challenges to nature, and trying, rather than with the classic British trope of trying to restore a golden age, looking to, well, what would be good in 2050? And I think thinking harder about that. There's quite a lot, the number of these things which are nice cuddly words, but there's a lot of lazy thinking. And I suspect that you don't want, in principle, then more objectives than you've got. But I think you do need to have them right. But do give the freedom to adapt to the future. The one thing we know is we're facing many more risks and challenges than we've been used to facing. And to run a good policy and a flexible, adaptive policy, we don't need to be tied to, don't need to suddenly run into the bill and have to rush legislation.
John, and then Rob and Douglas.
Yeah, I think going back to one of the points Jeremy made, I think when it comes to young people coming into the industry, or they're maybe, taking over a family farm and they're looking at what they can do going forward, and then they see words like sustainable and regenerative, and there's not a lot of clarity around what these words are.
That's what your granddad used to do, John.
I know, yeah. Things like that, their fathers aren't keen to let them take over the ropes, but then they want to look at what they want to do going forward, and then they see these words and there's not a lot of clarity around them, and it just doesn't really help the whole moving forward with their business. And I think that's, just words like that, and how that'll be policed, and do we have the resources to monitor that, and just going forward, just a bit more clarity around these buzzwords to help people move forward.
Okay, thank you. Rob.
Thanks. In terms of the objective, I think it is important that there is a community's objective within this. As Stephen says, if it doesn't go here, where does it go? I think we should also recognise that thriving rural communities isn't just going to be delivered by this bill and the funding that sits behind this bill. It's lots of aspects of government that are charged with delivering that. I guess that's why we're looking at a rural delivery plan. I think in terms of the CLLD, it has been a really valuable component of supporting communities with on-the-ground projects. I think its value, particularly when we were in Europe, when it had multi-annual funding, which allowed strategic thinking in communities, a long-term thinking, I think we've lost some of that with in-year funding. So I would urge thinking to get us back to a situation where communities can think more strategically, they have the time to plan and the time to deliver, and they don't have the pressure, which is damaging to some communities, of having to do these things very, very quickly.
Douglas.
Just in terms of the objectives, I reiterate, I think there is the fair income for farmers and crofters would be one that I would love to see there. And the other one I have, looking at the CAP objectives, the other one I have a great deal of sympathy for is the position of farmers and crofters within the food chain. And I know I would support SOS's call for help to position the industry within the market as the purchasing power of this. The subsidy has already been eroded. That's a trajectory that's likely to continue. So I think I would support that as another objective.
Thank you. Jim, supplementary.
Yeah, I'm going to go back a wee bit, if that's okay, convener, to the point that Douglas and Stephen were both talking about, and that is the role of tenants and how they become involved in the objectives of what the government are actually looking to do, the difficulties that will face. And it's not just about secure tenants, it's about guys who are on 25-year leases, etc. Is there going to be a problem in actually being able to allow these folk to get involved and deliver the objectives on the basis of they might not be part of the partnership in delivering the long-term goals that we're trying to achieve as tenants and as people who are on 25-year leases?
I think there are some real barriers there at the moment for the tenancy sector, and it's just a matter of making sure we get these barriers down. I mean, even something as simple as the rules of good husbandry and good estate management, if you like, are there. And if you delve into them, an agricultural lease tells a tenant that they must adhere to these rules of good husbandry, which fly in the face of much of what's going to come under Tier 2 and environmental management. So there is obviously a potential risk of a tenant in 3 being in breach of the lease because they carry out some environmental improvements. So we need to sort that out. There are all sorts of issues with tenants and trees and permissions from landlords for planting, diversification I've already mentioned, and under the what's called the Schedule 5 of list of improvements that tenants can be compensated for when they come out of the tenancy, there is a huge job to do to bring that up to date, to make sure that if tenant farmers engage in this whole process, that if they get to the end of the tenancy, that improvement they've carried out in the farm is recognised and can be compensated. So, again, this is all Land Reform Act stuff now, but it's critically important. Where we have even bigger concerns, I think, would be in the relationship between government funding and private funding in terms of the general move in terms of environmental management and greening and everything else, green capital. It's really difficult for tenants in their current position to engage with that side of thing. Carbon credits, all the rest of it.
Is there a danger then that tenants and leaseholders are just going to go, this isn't going to work for me, I'll do the absolute minimum and continue to take as much base payment as I can?
The risk is there. The way the four-tier model has been developed, I don't think there's many of our members can probably afford to take that view. If you look at the direct payments, say half is going to be Tier 1 base payment, half, the other half is going to be the Tier 2, that's a considerable proportion of their income, probably more than the profit for a lot of them. So there's going to have to be a way to allow them to participate. I don't think there'll be many of our members could say, no, it's not for me, and we'll just keep going. It's we have a higher proportion of members who are livestock farmers, and it's really challenging to make a living without that support. So, we've got to be optimistic and push that we don't find ourselves in that situation.
I've got Jeremy, Stephen, I think, at the moment on this, and I'm going to bring you back in, Sarah.
Well, thanks. There are always going to be issues where you have divided interests in ownership. I think that's quite clear. The question was couched in terms of the longer-term tenancies, the 91 Act tenancies, or the longer LDTs, MLDTs. A tenant is there to be in business to earn an income. That's the basic ground of security. And they'll look at this, therefore, logically as being, where are the business propositions? And that will then turn on, can I do it? Is there the money in it to warrant it? Can I make those commitments? And in the shape of a longer-term tenancy, there is at least the time period in which to do it. The shorter tenancies are probably much more commercial in outlook, and we'll take an even more commercial view on that. A longer tenancy may look to view stuff alongside owner-occupier neighbours and just think, well, where are my rights in this? There's a moderate amount of positive proposals in what we expect to come through in the Land Reform Bill. The reform of the list of compensatable improvements to embrace some of these things. But, of course, that depends on these actually being improvements that have value. And at the moment, there is an awful lot of talk about these things being terribly important, not necessarily evidence as to what actually has value to the incoming tenant that would generate the end of tenancy payment. And so I think there are pragmatic and practical questions around this. If money starts flowing, then pragmatic owners and tenants are more than capable of coming to deals. Clearly, those who are across to each other might find that more a source of challenge. But if the money is not flowing, or it doesn't make rational economic sense, then they will step back and they will pursue what best puts bacon on their table in the morning.
Thank you. Stephen.
Yeah, I think Jeremy and Douglas have picked up on a couple of the points that I would make, but that I do quite a lot of talks up and down the country on future agricultural support, crystal ball gazing. And the one thing that strikes me the most is it's the seasonal grazers, the landless keepers that we have, who have a flock of sheep or some cows, but they don't actually own land. And for them, this is a really confusing landscape, because how are they meant to do soil testing? How are they meant to do carbon audits? How are they meant to do, you know, for them, this is really confusing. So it's not just about those with secure tenancies or limited duration tenancies, whatever. It's also about those that are trying to get in. And these are quite often new entrants to the industry. They're trying to get established as a business. And for them, you know, quite a lot after meetings, there's a lot of people come up and ask about those types of questions. And we need to make sure that those things are better defined in the bill, which takes me right back to the definitional aspect. What are we doing? So what is agricultural activity? We need to properly define that to ensure that things like peatland restoration and biodiversity improvements are within that, and it becomes part of our general vocabulary around agriculture, so that farmers aren't limited. In the existing legislation on LFA, if you do peatland restoration and fence it off, technically that land's no longer eligible for support. So we need to start joining those dots up, and what is agricultural land? What is an active farmer? Because without those definitions, then where the money flows and what the barriers to the flow of the money are currently unseen. And it's not until you have those conversations with those on the ground that really start getting in there. Just coming right back to the original bit on the objectives. The objectives need to be really broad. I totally agree with Jeremy. They need to be really broad. It's whether or not you want things like practices or a sector. So instead of sustainable and regenerative agricultural practice, you could have sustainable and regenerative agriculture or a sector. You know, the actual wording in here, it just needs tweaked to enable it to be all-encompassing. The one thing that if you were looking at European Union, and if we were to align with European Union, they have a massive emphasis on supporting small farmers, or small producers, and also generation renewal. And that would be the two things that I think need a bit more explicit mentioning in the objectives.
I'm very conscious of time, so very briefly, Jeremy, I know you need to come back in that comment.
I just wanted to pick up on Stephen's very important point about the agricultural world out there in reality, which is that we have spent the last 20 years essentially rewarding land occupation. And the tenant, as a tenant, is an occupier of land. I mean, a real place in the party when it comes to looking at the schemes, however much the agreement and the landlord relationship may complicate that. Something like, it's been said, 40% of sheep farmers don't occupy land. They are there as graziers one way or another. They've been outside the payment system in the main, unless things have been done that shouldn't have been done in terms of who's been claiming what and so forth, but they have no ability to cross-comply on most things. They've been getting on with the business of life and so on. And it does come back to who you want to... What are you trying to use public money for? Who are you trying to ask to do it? And how are you going to get your objective? And if the aim is, in a livestock world, the man with the sheep or the woman with the sheep or the cattle, then that's a different question from who is occupying the land. And these overlap and intersect, but it's quite an important challenge if we're looking at some of the issues that we've been touching on. And then the Land Reform Bill, again, the skeleton proposals for the land use tenancy would provide for new agreements, what looks to be quite a positive framework for landlord, tenant and environmental climate change and agricultural practices. But we've yet to see the bill and we've yet to see it come out as an act.
Thank you. Sarah.
Very briefly, thank you, Convener. Agree with the points around definitions and flexibility of definitions that was made. In relation to the objectives, in our submission, with reference to the RSE submission on the bill, we made a point about the resources associated with objectives. So I think there needs to be, it's a nuance, but there needs to be some scrutiny of the feasibility of delivery of objectives in relation to resource. And the, in terms of your question about omission, in our submission we talked about the omission of any mention of local and regional land use strategies. So there needs to be some linking up, coming back to an earlier point. Thank you.
It ties in nicely. Now move to a question from Beatrice to close this first theme.
Thanks, Convener. My question is around how we know the objectives, how we know in the future how we're making progress. So I wonder if witnesses could comment on how that progress towards meeting the objectives should be measured, monitored and evaluated, and for whose benefit is that?
You'd like to kick off. Stephen.
Which comes back to my point, is that there needs to be scrutiny of this over the life of the bill, in that, or the Act, in that the plan technically is the government's set of objectives. It should set what they're aiming to deliver, and set targets to which then the government can be monitored against progress. And that can be decided. Part of the issue that we have is we've probably not done monitoring and evaluation of environmental aspects of agricultural support particularly well in the past, and we significantly need to improve that. And my slight concern is that we're going to start embarking on habitat assessments, carbon audits, soil testing, all of which are really important baseline environmental data, but we don't have the mechanisms to capture that just now. So we may know what the baseline is, but that will sit with farmers or the agents. So actually demonstrating the measurable benefits on a farm-by-farm basis or a region-by-region basis is going to be challenging unless we better understand how to capture data and utilise that data, because we currently aren't doing that.
Yeah. Grant, then Jeremy.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is a really important point in terms of what you're monitoring, at what scale, over what length of time. There's obviously the on-farm side of things. There's quite a lot of work at the moment going on in terms of trying to look at how we monitor that, how we get baselines, and then how we do that. But you know, you look at some of these objectives, and they're about climate change, they're about nature restoration. These are not five-year blocks of things. You know, doing work over a 4 or 5 year period will not lead to that straight away. Some of these things are 30, 40, 50. You know, take peatland restoration, tree, woodland, you know, you're talking into the, you know, decades and decades of time. So we've got to think about what we can measure in terms of the outcomes that we're getting at certain points and the milestones, but we tend to measure inputs, is what we tend to do, and then we say that that's success. But actually what we've shown is that actually those inputs have not been leading. If you look at any of the biodiversity stats in Scotland, they're not going in the right direction. but the amount of input that we're putting in would suggest, well, why has that been happening? So there's a disconnect between those two things. So the monitoring is really, really important as to what that framework looks like, what you're measuring at a national level, what you're measuring at a regional level, what you're measuring at an on-farm level, and have consistency over time, not chopping and changing some of that as well. So I think that, you know, it's a really, really key issue for us, is that if you're going to meet these objectives, you're going to have a good monitoring framework around that that is both, it's at different levels all the way through the system.
Thank you. Hey, Jeremy.
I suggest that the monitoring isn't of the objectives, but of a clearly defined rural support plan. That's where you lay out the granular detail. The point about outcomes is fundamental, and I think this would reveal quite how challenging what we're being asked to do is. Very few ecologists, I think, believe that turning around biodiversity loss is an easy task to be done within a handful of years. The climate change targets reducing greenhouse gas emissions at the scale that's being demanded of agriculture is clearly more challenging than we have yet risen to. But it's for the rural support plan, I think, to lay these things out. I think there are probably some very hard figures in that, and that will make the monitoring both essential and challenging.
Thank you, Karina. We mentioned this in the RSE's submission on the bill, the importance of monitoring. In addition, coming back to a point I made at the beginning, there is a wealth of data relating to LEADER and now CLLD, and I would recommend a systematic, it can be brief, but a systematic analysis of what's already been achieved, because I think for this bill, particularly when we're talking about smaller resources potentially, we need to say, well, what is now going to be the objective? What's different now, looking forward, from what's already been achieved with LEADER and CLLD at national, regional and local levels? And therefore, what are the specific objectives? And what's the baseline now? Because in 30 years, there is evidence of what has been achieved. This is now going to be 2025. What now should CLLD be achieving? What's the new baseline? What are the objectives? And therefore, what monitoring needs to take place? And we have, again, a wealth of monitoring frameworks from previous decades that can be adapted and utilised for the next phase.
Okay, thank you. We're now going to move on to the next thing, which is around the Code of Practice for Sustainable and Regenerative Agriculture. And you'll be pleased to see you here after this section. We'll stop for a comfort break. Alistair Allen.
Thank you very much. Now, forgive me, convener, we're talking about the second theme here, aren't we? So, I was interested, one of the things that's been talked about in the past is about what checks and balances there should be around the bit that comes after the Act, the action that ministers have, and particularly I'm thinking in terms of the Code of Practice here. So one of those checks and balances would come down to whether Section 7 of the Bill was subject to the negative procedure or not in Parliament. Now, that's a very technical point, but it opens up the wider question about what the scrutiny should be of the decisions that ministers make on the back of the Bill. But I'm particularly interested in the Code of Conduct.
or just to address the more general points on the Code of Conduct, Stephen, and then Douglas.
Yeah, I mean, to me, the question is still not answered: whether the Code of Practice will be binding, whether it will establish a new rule set, where it will be part of cross-compliance, or if it is just a guidance for best practice, because it's going to be challenging to define all of those things. And I do take some comfort in the session you had with officials when the head of agricultural policy did suggest that you don't need to define regenerative agriculture, you don't need to define high-quality food, because these are things that have been vexing some of us for a while as to how you're going to define all of these things to then monitor them. So the broad set of principles as to what it, and his words in that session were about if it's if it's defined too rigidly, then what is regenerative in one part of the country may not be regenerative in, the, in another. So it has to just be a set of principles and guidance in my from my perspective, and that then, if it's not legally binding, then does it? You know, what level of scrutiny then is required by Parliament? I'm more concerned about the Rural Support Plan as having a greater deal of scrutiny rather than the Code of Practice, personally. Yeah, that's where I would be. Whether it goes negative or affirmative, I think in our submission, I did highlight that there was an awful lot of statutory instruments that potentially could be coming down the track, to which there may be limited ability for stakeholders to scrutinise, i.e. if we get a huge tranche of statutory instruments. Sarah mentioned earlier on community fatigue. There certainly will be stakeholder fatigue, and you as a committee may get fatigued at some point.
Before I bring in Douglas, it certainly, again, the DPLR committee accepted that that there were some absolutely valid reasons for the government to take powers within the bill. However, the wide scope and range of ministerial powers gives rise to concern, because it's a framework bill which ultimately could reduce the ability of the committee and the Parliament as a whole to scrutinise the legislation, and the, you know, the code of conduct will come, or code of practice will come into that. So maybe Douglas could respond to Alistair and address that as well.
I'm essentially going to echo what Stephen has said. I mean, the support plan is the fundamental part, and given the lack of detail in the bill as it stands at the moment, that scrutiny of the secondary legislation, because it's so fundamentally important, I think is key. Like Stephen, I'm not sure how the code of practice will fit into all this, either from a timing point of view or legislative point of view. But if it is actually going to have some teeth, then scrutiny is, you know, we'd support that 100%.
Okay. Jeremy.
I think once a code like this is written, it tends to hang around and turn up in places that get to surprise you. And I would pick out of Stephen's response the concern about the sheer variety of circumstances within Scotland. And I suppose a particular challenge for parts of Scottish agriculture would be to ask how would a code of regenerative practice bear on potato farming with its inevitable disruption of soil and so on. And again, and if it's written broad enough to handle that, I'm conscious of the sheep farmers who would go organic, be registered as organic, but for their welfare concerns that lead them to want access to medication. And it's these sorts of things where everybody will feel they're in the right part of the spectrum, but the rules could be written such that it's really rather awkward for more people than you would like. And so these things come with unexpected consequences, and particularly somewhere down the line where it gets thrown at somebody in anger. This could be more dangerous than you might have thought.
Grant.
I'd echo most of the comments in terms of, I suppose it all depends on whether it is a guide or it's a set of rules. If it's written at such a high level that it covers all the different types of agricultural and the different types of land use all across Scotland, it's going to be very high level. And I think you'd then just about fit anything underneath it. And then if you try and make it very prescriptive and you've got to take account of all the regional variations, it becomes a bloody big document. And I suppose the other bit is just, it would be good to think about the experience we've had with other codes that we've got in other sectors, because we've got quite a lot of other codes. There's quite a lot of codes that came out through the Scottish Land Commission side of things. There's been quite a few codes on the deer side of things. There's been codes on Muirburn. You know, how have these worked? Have they been successful in what they set out to do when they were put in place? I think it'd be worth having to think about that in terms of the existing suite of codes and guidance out there and how this might fit into that. But I think it is that question about what it is, really does fundamentally, you know, depends on your point of view in terms of that, but I think there's quite a lot of different variation in that. And if it is something you then have to make people adhere to, I think that's where it gets a bit tricky in terms of a code of guidance. I suspect it's more just a practice guide for people and rather than a specific you must do, but that's to be decided.
Yeah, far from it for me to summarise, but it sounds like there's not too much concern over the code of practice as long as the rural support plan is quite clear in the direction of travel. Is that the... Stephen?
I mean, and again, I don't want to speak for officials or anything, but I imagine the code of practice would be explaining how people engaging in Tier 2 measures, so the conditionality measures, will actually help deliver on regenerative and sustainable agriculture. It's what I would imagine the code should be discussing, but I haven't had sight of any of it, so I'm only second-guessing this.
Okay. Right, oh, that'll bring the end to this session. We'll pause until 10:40 when we come back to look at the rural support plan and suspend the meeting. Okay, we now resume, and we move to our third theme for this morning, which is the Rural Support Plan, and a question from Rachel Hamilton.
Earlier in the conversation, or in the round table, it was pointed out that the DPLR committee has had difficulty in understanding why the first rural support plan is not at more an advanced stage. And there have been comments in terms of calls for view made on this particular angle, and that there's not a clear direction of travel which the DPLR committee themselves agree with. What they would like to see, and what I would like to know from witnesses, is whether they agree that a draft plan should be published ahead of stage three of the Agricultural Bill, and should that be subject to statutory consultation, and also on the point of annual scrutiny of the Parliament, should there be a place for that. Can I perhaps start with Stephen Seen, as you made the initial comments around this?
Well, you've heard me confirm your thoughts on the last part, which is that I think that needs to have parliamentary scrutiny on an annual basis to monitor progress throughout the life of the bill. I suppose from an official's perspective, and again, I'm not putting words in officials' mouths, but I can see the challenges of delivering a plan by stage three, simply because they still have not fully drafted the secondary legislation, which then means that they don't have a full grasp of the measures and targets that they're actually trying to deliver on. So this iterative approach that the framework bill is permitting means that they will not have the full list of tier two measures. They will not have the full design of tier three, which then means setting targets, setting objectives, and explaining where the money will go is probably more challenging than we're all giving government officials credit for.
But how long have we known that this bill was coming forward? You know, when you're saying there's... Well, I suppose I'm challenging you. This is the role of this committee, is actually to look at the positives of this bill, but also potentially highlighting some of the issues and how we can get around those. Should we not be in a position where just weeks before we vote on this bill, which will give the government power to create secondary legislation with the limited scrutiny that comes with that, should we not be further ahead of the game, particularly when, you know, this bill has got to be delivered because there's going to be a gap if we don't?
Well, my perspective is that we should have had written a CAP strategic plan type approach from day one, because that's the justification. So we need to justify why we need to continue supporting agriculture in whichever way we choose to support it, and rural communities. I shouldn't forget that element. So from my perspective, the logic would have been to deliver to mock up a plan and then tweak the plan as you go forward with the secondary legislation. So the plan is an iterative approach. You can't have a plan that you know, you could have a plan that's laid before Parliament before stage three. That would give you some indication of where the direction of travel, what the objectives are, what the budgetary allocations. I mean, in our submission, I talked about the need or the missing part of the jigsaw is minimum spend per tier, minimum spend per type of project or support mechanism. So if the government were to do that and then amend that at a later stage, once they've got clarity of the secondary legislation and the detail of the support mechanisms that they've got coming forward, it may mean that they're going to have to submit the support plan in iterative stages. But you're not going to get that fine detail. And I take your point, is that, we wrote in our submission that the Agricultural Champions described what this framework was back in 2018.
Thank you. Jeremy.
Yes. Your challenge is entirely to the point. I am really quite concerned about the tightness of the timetable for delivering these policies on the programme that's been outlined, on the timescale for this. It's been slipping and slipping. We now have the bill. The support plan, I think Stephen's answer is probably the only practical answer, but the only practical way to achieve delivery is to get on. Because after the bill is in place, after we know what's in the first, let's take Stephen's approach, the first draft of the support plan, we then have the statutory instruments to work through, we have the detailed IT development all to do, the graveyard of many policies. You know, all this is on a tight timescale. Watching the timescales now in Wales, where they've run it against the line for starting something in April 25, this is getting really very tight. So I suppose the answers to your first question are, yes, it should be out before stage three, subject to Stephen's refinements as to process. Can you afford a consultation period in that? Probably not. You've been consulting, the government's been consulting on lots of policies for lots of time. It's just not always in places that people have been looking. And then crack on. It's parliamentary scrutiny, clear, because that is actually the means of delivering a high-level act. The support plan is the ghost in the machine.
Douglas.
Just to add to what Stephen and Jeremy have said, I think the other important bit that's missing is much wider stakeholder engagement in this draft secondary legislation. It's something we've been requesting for quite a long time, that meaningful engagement, and it's not there yet. I think there's a pretty small circle of people who have got a real awareness of everything that's going on, but that needs to be a much, much wider circle of people that get their opportunity.
You furnished me originally with the Tenant Farmers magazine, and on that there was a specific piece around agricultural support payments, which actually criticised the lack of meaningful engagement. However, then went on to say that you were pleased to see that, born out of the frustration of that, that the FAST group was set up. Can you tell the committee how the FAST group is now engaging with the government in terms of that meaningful engagement that you're looking for?
We've really just got started, Rachel. The last meeting that we had, face-to-face meeting we had, the Cabinet Secretary did attend. That was a full year on from when the request was made for meaningful engagement. But I think now that FAST group of agricultural stakeholders is now being recognised as a useful sounding board. It's probably not where it needs to be. And the bit that's missing is a sort of overarching picture of where everything is. We can get reports from various civil servants on how things are progressing in Tier 2 or Tier 4. I was at a meeting on Tier 4 yesterday, giving them a tuppence worth on the informal consultation. But actually, how is this all coming together to be a meaningful rural support plan to allow stakeholders to have their say? It's still not satisfactory, I think, Rachel, would be my... Okay. It's challenging and frustrating. We're here already willing to play our part in helping government and officials in their thinking, but there's probably not been wide enough engagement. There's too much still getting to my ears through the grapevine rather than through proper channels, and we need to get these channels sorted out so that we can have our say and make our contribution.
Okay, Sarah.
Thank you, Convener. Given the rural support plan is around carrying out the functions of the bill, I agree around the urgency, and also it would seem to me that this is where issues of definition and monitoring and evaluation need to be bottomed out.
John. Yeah, I can just come back to what Duke said, just looking at how all this is coming together is actually going to form a plan that we're all obviously going to have to follow in years to come. I think that's been slow at the moment, and I think the quicker that can happen, the better from our point of view.
Thank you. Rhoda Grant.
Just to follow up on what people were asking about in scrutiny of the support plan, do you think, there's obviously two ways in legislation to lay, either by affirmative instrument or a negative instrument. Affirmative, you have to vote for it. Negative, you have to move against it. And I wonder if, given the importance of this, where we should be asking for a super affirmative procedure, where we ask government to lay a draft of the instrument first so that the committee can comment, that we can take wider consultation on it and report back to government before they submit the final instrument, because given the importance of it, it would allow time for people to feedback. Would that be something people would support?
Any comments? Stephen?
I feel like I'm saying a lot. Yes, I given the strategic importance of the plan, the having 40 days scrutiny doesn't seem like an awful lot of time for your committee and Parliament to consider it. So whether you go to super affirmative and actually have you can call for evidence, that's probably in the long term that must be needed if we're going to use the support plan. And again, this isn't in the bill, but you may want to consider the role of the support plan to scrutinise the annual spend expenditure and actually delivery on that on the objectives. And if you are going to do that, then you probably need to change that process if that support plan is going to be used for what I'm suggesting, rather than what it's in the bill for just now. It kind of depends on what the purpose of the plan is, and I'm suggesting the plan might deliver more than what it's currently in the bill for.
That, I'm going to bring Jeremy. That kind of brings us to another question we're going to ask about the areas in which the Scottish ministers must have regard to, or matters to be considered, which are in section 3 of the bill. So that will inform what the plan should be. So maybe in further comments, we have a look at, or you consider in your responses, what the government should have regard to. Jeremy.
Yeah, just going to support, because if in practice, the rural support plan is the real bill within the framework bill. And that would seem to me to be an essential role for Parliament, looking at then the genuine allocations of expenditure and conditions and so forth. It is tantamount to a bill, and so it would seem to me that the processes for that give Parliament some hold on it. I was rather intrigued by the issue of things you must have regard to as to how they actually relate with objectives. It's a double take, and obviously a direct reference to the climate change plan, almost implied in the objective of climate mitigation and adaptation, but nonetheless, any other statutory duty, well, of course, they presumably would have to have regard to that, whether or not it was here. So it's slightly strange, I suppose, is my immediate reaction looking at it.
So again, I've said this a number of times when we've had stakeholders in front of us. We're now at the real business end of this. We're almost at the end of the process of looking at this bill. We've spent quite some time scrutinising it. Do we need amendments, firstly, to make the objectives clearer? And those clearer objectives then need to link to amendments which do include a list of matters to be considered. Is that something we need to look at as a committee? Jeremy, would you like to come back in?
I think the earlier discussion was fairly clear that amendments to the objectives would be sensible to give them longer legs for the future. And having just looked on your immediate prompting again at the list of what factors to be had, regards to be had to, I'm struggling to see actually what that section actually adds. Which bit of climate change mitigation and adaptation would not consider the climate change plan? Which statutory duty are you proposing to disregard? It's almost superfluous if we get the objectives right. Sorry, it's an immediate reaction to the question you posed.
I guess there's not an exhaustive list. When we look at the... I'm going to say clutter. The clutter of legislation that's in front of us, and I don't mean that in a... there is lots of legislation, whether it's land reform, whether it's the biodiversity plan, climate change plan, a whole range of different pieces of legislation. Do we need to name them with have regard to, or do you believe that there could be a form of words which would ensure that we could hold the government to account to ensure that all these considerations are actually part of the plan? Rachel, and I'll bring in Sarah.
I was just going to say that considering the conversation that we've had earlier regarding modernising agricultural tenancies and the land reform bill, which is we haven't seen a draft of yet, I think it's difficult to take Jeremy's point at face value when it's not obvious that we know what with the climate change plan, we do know what we're trying to achieve, but in terms of modernising agricultural tenancies and then ensuring that farmers are supported to make the changes with the conditionality, I think it's very difficult if it's not written down implicitly.
Did Grant, did you signal to come in, or...?
Yeah, I suppose it's the thing about if you put into legislation specific things, that stuff changes. And it changes quite rapidly, let's face it. I mean, if you go back when we did the last Scottish Rural Development Programme and you wrote out what were the key things that you needed to take account of, and you look at that then and this now, chalk and cheese in terms of where we are. So I suppose my worry is if you start listing things out, you end up in 5 years' time, that list won't make a lot of sense and you're going to be stuck with it. So I think there's something about having some flexibility in there, about having regard to the relevant pieces of legislation and statutory plans that exist that impact on agriculture and wider rural communities or something like that. But it would capture, hopefully, most things, because, you know, there'll be a bit of legislation that comes along in 3 years' time that nobody's talking about at the moment that will be relevant to this, that I think needs to be taken into account of.
A very valid point. And if you do look at the bill as drafted, there is a list of certain things which might lead someone to suggest if it's not on the list, the government don't have to pay regard to it. So we have got things like development of law and policy of the European Union, other statutory duties of the Scottish ministers relating to agriculture. So there would be a concern if you start to create a list, it's not what's on the list, it's actually what is missing from the list. So that's helpful. I think Sarah wanted to come in on that.
Following on from both your points, to me it's about addressing the risk that was identified earlier of responsibilities otherwise falling between the cracks if they're not made explicit within this bill, whilst acknowledging that if you get too specific, then the bill becomes outdated quite rapidly. So I wonder if it is something like Grant suggesting, where areas of responsibility or themes of legislation can then be specified without getting into particular acts or policies or plans, so that those are of a high enough level that they can embrace certain areas but aren't too specific, because otherwise we haven't got risk mitigation in there of areas being left out.
Okay. Thank you. Stephen?
Yeah. I mean, this is the jigsaw puzzle, is what you're talking about here, is that those of us that live and breathe this understand that there's a massive jigsaw puzzle that impinges on all of the stuff that the bill is doing. So to pick out one or two of the specific pieces of legislation did stand out, and that water quality wasn't in there. So, and water quality is not in there, and wider environmental protection is not even in the objectives. Rather, it's climate and biodiversity, because those are the emergencies we're currently faced with. So you do risk the fact that you do risk that this is just a could it be seen as just subservient to just the climate change plan, rather than actually a wider suite of important pieces of legislation, you know, the Islands Act and all of the things that we need to do, consideration of crofting, consideration of tenure, consideration of wider rural economy, consideration of all of the aspects that this bill is going to impinge on. And welcome, that's the nature of farming. It impinges on an awful lot of things that we're trying to achieve as society. That's up to you guys whether you think it's vital to list things or not. But I don't think it is. If you get the right wording, you can just say it has to take account of all of the relevant pieces of legislation and plans. Noting that the Good Food Nation plan says that this bill has to have, or the agricultural support has to have acknowledged the plan.
Okay, thank you. Duncan. Douglas, bigger plan.
Sorry, just to add to that, it would be nice to see some evidence of that cross-cutting referral that's taken place in the process. I'm not sure how you achieve that from a parliamentary perspective, but it would be really nice to see that we've had a think about this. We have had a look at Good Food Nation. We have had a look at what we're called, whatever it is, and this is our conclusion, without maybe specifying them all in here.
It's quite interesting. I think it's Environmental Link created a chart of all the legislation that came together and interacted with each other relating to rural, and it was on a A3 sheet of paper, and the writing was still so small I could hardly read it. So that gives you a sort of a picture of the amount of legislation that is out there that will potentially impact this bill. I'm going to now move on to our next theme, which is develop a new agricultural support system. And a question from Alistair Allen. Sorry, I'm getting my AAs, my ABs mixed up. Ariane Burgess.
Convener. Yes, so as Convener said, we're going to move into the theme of powers to provide support. So part two of the bill is the part which gives Scottish ministers the power to establish a new funding and support system for Scottish agriculture. So I've got a number of questions in this area, and some of them we kind of actually started to touch on already under theme one, so I might not rehearse that. But kind of very specifically, because as the Convener keeps saying, we're in the business end, I'd be interested to hear if you believe the powers will enable the ministers to ensure there is a just transition, and not just for farmers, but for the wider rural communities. And this is coming in the context of the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero and Just Transition announcing the climate mitigation adaptation plan recently. So I just wonder if you think the powers will are going to be enough to get us, not only for farmers, but also for the rural communities, to where we need to be going.
And we'll maybe kick off with Sarah, because she's not catching my eye, and that's always a good choice of who to go to.
Could I have some think time, please?
You certainly can. Stephen.
Yes, it's required. And the powers to maintain existing legislation and amend it and then introduce new legislation is what the framework is all about, in order to make sure that come 2026, or whenever the new piece of legislation come forward, we don't just simply flick a switch. So we need to be able to tear off of the existing system and ramp up the new system. And if we don't have that power, then you don't have a just transition. You don't enable people to make the changes that will be required to deliver against the new set of objectives. Whether or not you amend objectives is a different matter. But that's an absolutely essential part of this. And it's also essential, if you think about it from a government IT system was mentioned earlier on, is we're going to have to somehow evolve the current system, and doing that in an iterative approach where we're bringing in new measures, new mechanisms and new support structures will require time to deliver on that as well.
Okay. Grant.
Support for everything you said there. I think the key bit around this is, I suppose, this word just transition, or the words just transition, and what it actually means, and how you actually do that. It's one of these things that's easy to say, but actually how you do that is the bit that's most difficult. And I think one of the things, it's about making sure that people are aware of the choices ahead of them as early as possible, so that people can make informed decisions. Because what you're wanting is for people to make informed decisions about what they want to do with their business, what they want to do in terms of trying to make sure they support their farming business or a wider rural business. And then, I suppose, from other point of view, is how that integrates other land use as well and other choices that are being made in other bills and other things that are coming through Parliament as well. So I think this is a crucial bit, which is, what does that landscape look like post-2026? How can you make sure that you're making decisions now that work with whatever that looks like? And how can we make sure we've got the right mechanisms in place to support people post-2026? Because I think that's one of the key things for me, is just the actual detail on what those measures are, what they look like, and how they do contribute to that wider just transition and those bigger things we're talking about in terms of climate and biodiversity restoration and all these other things as well, because I think that is the key bit. But you need the powers to be able to do that. I think that we've got to be able to look at that support, but the sooner we can get some of that detail out, the easier it will be for people to then understand where it's going and be able to make decisions.
Jeremy.
Yes, I think what this bill does is it breaks out of the straitjacket of your 2020 Act. And it allows you to write new law, not just simply very limited amendments of legacy law. And I think that's critical to doing whatever is wanted. That's an absolutely critical assumption of powers and needed. And then I think it's worth spending just a little more time on Stephen's point about managing the phased transition. We are in a country, all the countries in the UK, where we are deeply embedded in historic subsidy systems. People have built businesses and debts and employment structures and so on around the structure of that. And there are two, that's one reason, allowing values and business plans and structures and generational change within families and so on to accommodate. And that can be done quite quickly, but it can't be done overnight. And so allowing a period for that to be phased, but at the other end, is actually getting the schemes right on the ground. And that's slightly more of an iterative process than possibly people initially imagine, given everything that's got to be done. And so a critical point, I think, in the Rural Support Plan, coming back to the earlier question, but very much linked to this, is having an outline of how people are phased from A to B, so that the new schemes come in, so that people can move at the point that suits them. And clearly, there are different models around as to how that is done. And we will learn, we will see how, for example, the Welsh one actually works. And we're watching Northern Ireland's phasing, as well as what's now effectively happened in England. But that needs to be planned, because that's actually how you handle the rather precious bars of people's businesses, that where they're good businesses, you want them to be there for the new world.
You were saying, Grant, really, that I think one strand of a good example will be its articulation. Again, we quote again the Good Food Nation Bill. I think we know that in terms of business models, crofters and farmers will produce food more for a local market if it aligns with local procurement and so on, and that will influence what they produce and the market, the routes to market that they take as a result of that. So I think the Good Food Nation Bill will give a mechanism, just one strand, that will help businesses plan and align with a different, you know, a more biodiverse way, if you like, of the way they are operating. And it will give them that framework and a market which will enable them to survive. And I think just building on that as well, I think we are seeing a younger generation of both younger farmers and younger crofters who are wanting to return to the land, and they're taking note of ways that their grandparents perhaps articulated by the likes of James Rebanks and others on how the land was managed historically, outdoor grazing, you know, all this kind of thing. So they too will be looking for a more localised market for this kind of farming as they move to a different model. And it's not easy. So we are talking about a just transition with the emphasis on just. It's not only about the climate, but it's about, if you're looking at an industry which is often inherited from previous generations, then telling your father or your mother that they got it wrong because of what they were told historically, but actually maybe their grandparents were more on track, then that needs support. It needs support from all of us to enable that just transition. I think as well, just mentioning the Welsh model you were talking about a moment ago, we know that the Welsh model is taking provision for the Welsh language and that cultural inheritance. And within Scotland, we have that, and not across the whole country, but certainly in the crofting counties, you have this notion of cultural inheritance, of knowing that your land was managed by people before you, and you are managing it going for those going ahead of you. This whole thing around Duchess, this business around indigenous skills. We know that 80% of the world's biodiversity, you know this, is looked after by 6% of the world's population who are indigenous peoples. So there's something about those historic knowledge and skills of managing the land in a biodiverse and sustainable way that fed people that our forebears knew about. And I think just recognising that as we move forward to support that just transition, I think we should be mindful of.
Thank you. John, and then Douglas.
Just touching on a point that Fiona made and Jeremy as well, I think, you know, as much as we need to legislate and kind of be more clear about what we mean in terms of our farming practices, I think in the future going forward, the big thing's going to be people. You know, in my daily job at the moment as a trainee auctioneer, I'm going around farms meeting people, and there's two war cries. One of them's the weather, but I don't think there's a policy that you can put in that will change that. and the other one also being the fact that they can't find people to work on farms. You know, the older generation of farm workers are either retired, you know, or about to retire, and the younger generation, you know, some of them are away doing different occupations, and other ones that are coming in either didn't come from a family farm and need trained, or, you know, there's different kind of barriers to getting people in. And I think that there needs to be an element of support in the plan that looks at how we actually structure the workforce going forward, because I think it's going to be one of the biggest issues, you know, apart from the farming practices and how we actually farm the land. I think who's actually going to be doing that work is possibly one of the biggest issues we're going to face going forward.
Thank you. Douglas.
Yeah, it was just to add to everything that's been said and make the point that at farm level, just transition for me is all about the no cliff edges, as has been quoted. But you've heard the committee said this before, but the long-term production cycles, particularly in livestock agriculture, make that phrase mean something very different to different farming types, if you like. And also just to emphasise the importance of a multi-annual budget framework in achieving that managed transition. It's absolutely fundamental to allow people that ability to look a bit further down the line and plan successfully.
Thank you. Stephen.
Yeah, I'm going to come back to the just transition element. In the Commission, we quite often talk about it as not just transition, it's the justice element of the transition is the most important aspect. And this ability to flex from existing systems into new systems is also going to have to be backed up with support for retraining, for helping people better understand what they need to better deliver, that might need more one-to-one support. We need to start really considering how we're going to support the most needy in the system. And I just acknowledge that there will be people that need to do that. There'll be some people that call themselves food producers just now that won't be food producers in the future. How are we going to support them in that transition? And I suppose what the bill is doing and what government are trying to do is a step change from what we've got, a very path-dependent agricultural system, in that quite a lot of the systems of support we've currently got are based on stocking densities in 1990s. You know, we're 25 years out. In terms of some of the mechanisms that we're delivering, and that continues to drive the path dependency that we've got, and this step change ain't going to be easy, and we need people to better understand that, and that's where that whole element of justice comes in. And as a phrase I've used a lot in the past is that the future is not what it used to be. We need to support people to better understand that. And
thank you, Sarah.
Thank you, Convener. In section 5, which is around the Leader Legacy Programme and CLLD, something that SRUC's report touched on and has been an issue for a long time is around the need for capacity building, and that this isn't, it builds on Stevie's point as well, this isn't something that generates immediate return and is an investment. Otherwise, what we've found over the years is that you have hot spots and not spots. So you have hot spots of communities that know how to use the system, and they succeed and they will continue to succeed. They will draw down funds and they know how to. And you will have those not spots where those communities don't have the capacity or don't know how to access the system and use the system, and that will continue. So there needs to be within this and within the plan definitive measures that will invest in capacity building and not just run with the successes that demonstrate the success of the bill and the success of the spend. So it's not, to use that word, it's not a sexy spend, but it's a necessary investment in a just transition.
Yeah, thank you.
I couldn't agree with you more, Sarah, because if you look at a family farming unit, there are varying skills within that unit, and not all the individuals are recognised as the primary producer or the actual farmer. And so I think if we can recognise that there's a wider input into making a productive and efficient and profitable farming enterprise, that we need to recognise that it's not just the farmer that we need to support, but it's the wider community, family members around, or even neighbours, you know, in terms of that sort of peer-to-peer whole systems approach.
In terms of the Women in Agriculture Task Force, there was work around that, you know, in terms of the whole farm unit and building capacity of women in agriculture. And there's even more need then for the monitoring and evaluation that you raised, Deputy Convener, around a baseline and knowing where we're moving from here. And being able to generate data around the just transition and knowing that progress has been made from 2025 onwards around these harder to grasp concepts and issues that are very real in rural Scotland.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I've got a couple of more detailed questions and I'm going to direct them to folks and I'll just ask them both, but I'll direct them to the folks so that you know it's coming your way. So for Douglas and Theonia, I've got a question around tenant farmers and crofters. And it's so the bill creates powers to support the use of land for woodlands where that use is ancillary to the farming of the land for other agricultural purposes. And I presume this could include support for croft woodlands that are being called for, agroforestry, park land and silver pasture. And I'd be interested to hear what your thoughts are in terms of tenant farmers and crofters. Do you think that they could benefit from that kind of support? And if not, what could we do to make sure that they do get that support? So that's one question, and then I'll ask the other one, which I'm also going to direct to Theona and Stephen, which is around just transition, but also I think both of you have touched on the piece, which is support which hasn't really been happening for small-scale local fruit and veg producers. And that's something that's coming up in conversations I'm having all across my region. And I would be interested to understand if you have a sense that... if that's important as a sector to rural communities, food security and local economies, and again, is there enough provision in the bill, enough hooks for us to actually ensure that that kind of support could come forward?
I'll ask Douglas to answer his questions first, and then Theona and Stephen.
Okay, in terms of tenancy legislation, tenants are allowed to plant trees that are ancillary to their farming operation. The problems come around definition of when is a shelter belt ancillary and when does it become a commercial woodland. Lots of issues around that. Even with that flexibility, though, there are pretty few tenants would actually plant trees. The issue for them is really around what happens potentially at the end of the lease, because that land has been taken out of agricultural production, and potentially they could be stung for dilapidations at the end of their tenancy because that land is now no longer fit for purpose for agriculture, and in theory they could be asked to either pay dilapidations or return it to previous agricultural condition. That's assuming that woodland doesn't have value at the end of the day, when then the whole thing is reversed and the tenant farmer would be looking for some sort of compensation that it has a value. But there's some big questions about, you know, because woodland's such a long term thing. Will it have value at the end after 20 years, or will it actually be something that has reduced the agricultural potential of the holding? So that is, you know, certainly. Probably wrapped into all this tenancy, modernisation of tenancy, we'd like to see some better definition, some more flexibility around that diversification into trees.
Thank you. Theona.
So I would agree what Douglas has just said, and obviously if succession planning is a challenge, then you run into all the things you've just spoken about. I think succession in some regards is perhaps more protected in crofting, but it doesn't mean to say there's someone there to take it on, so you know that's another issue. I think obviously living in a place where trees are a bit thin on the ground, this notion of silvopasture and its contribution to biodiversity and to supplement and enhance the crofting activity and livestock and stocking density, all of that, you know, we can talk forever about that. But I think it definitely, if there is support around that, I think crofters would definitely embrace that because they have done in the past for shelter belts and so on. And then, of course, the livestock benefit from that shelter, and then the leaf fall, you know, gives different components to the soil, which the cattle appreciate. We're not in a room to discuss all of that, but I think it's a good thing. Yeah. Do you want me to come on to the small-scale fruit and veg thing? Okay, so, I mean, we know that 70% of the world is kind of fed from 2 acres of parcels of land that are 2 acres or less. I know, and I have evidence, that, you know, if I go back a couple of generations, what our islands, that is the Outer Hebrides, actually imported was very little, and I can demonstrate that. So it was sugar, tea, strawberry jam. You know, I jest, but it's true. I've got the invoices to show you, the cargo ships coming in from Glasgow. So what does that mean? That we were in that 70% where really we were producing most of what we need. I was in Glencairns at the weekend at their food hub, and I was putting lemons into a bag, and I said, well, these are not grown locally. And she said, no, at these hungry months we buy from Organic North and, you know, put in foods that we know the provenance of the food and where it's come from, but the rest of the year we're using local produce. So to come on to what you were saying, Ariane, I mean, I think there needs to be more support because we see more local food producers serving communities. Research in our islands told us that we were vulnerable because we didn't have mainstream supermarkets. Well, we are not, because we are delivering local lamb, beef, salmon, venison to our elderly people in our community, supported by potatoes, carrots, onions, rhubarb crumble, you know, as meals for the elderly in our community. The health board should be on that project, never mind everybody else, when the crofters and the social enterprises delivering that are involved, because that will impact people's lives and their health and well-being, not only food security and shorter food miles, environmental concerns and everything else, but just an altogether local economy model that is resilient in a rural community. So, but you're right, historically these small-scale producers, I was at the Oxford Real Farm, sorry, convener, if I may, I was at the Oxford Real Farming Conference recently, and I took 4 young crofters to speak on low-intensive agricultural model that is crofting, that is a mixed model that is biodiverse and actually can be a model for the future. However, looking at an audience of more than 100 people, thinking we don't necessarily want them all to come up the A9 looking for crofts. So it would be useful if they could consider a literacy of understanding of the food that can be and is being produced where they are, and if they would share that information with us. I came home with a list this long from the Isles of Scilly to the Isle of Skye of local food producers who are serving communities, which, convener, I will tell you, do not appear on any supermarket share charts, and yet they are feeding communities. And we need to wake up to this, because this will help us address the just transition. Hamidoulik, sorry.
Jim, and then I'll move to Stephen.
Just a very brief question on that. Do the communities that are getting that food, are they looking for more exotic stuff?
No.
Because the first thing that sprung to my mind there was this demand from society for everything exotic. So are the local communities comfortable with what you can actually grow and eat in your own area?
Well, as I said before, you know, even the place in Glencairns is putting in organic lemons, so it's not like you're not getting your lemons, so to speak, but it's proportional. So if 70 or 80%, I'm making those figures up, so don't quote me on that, of your food is locally sourced, if you like, then we totally accept that if you want a banana or you want lemons, then you would bring them in. Does that make sense to you? But they also seem to value that local provenance, We all know that a homegrown carrot tastes better than a shop-bought one.
Yes,
indeed. Yeah.
There's a lot in those statements by Doug and Fiona. On Douglas, I'll just add a little bit to Douglas's, and then I'll answer the question specifically of me, is that we're talking about public policy, and we already know that the private sector market's changing dramatically in terms of Scope 3 emissions, whether that's on climate and or biodiversity net gain will come in the future. So we know that food producers are going to have to start delivering better on that. And one of the risks that we have, both in private and public sector, is the tenant and or rented sector, where they have got less, if they have less opportunity, then how do they tick these green credentials? And that is a big risk. So if there's market failure, and there may well be market failure, that's the role of government to intervene. And that's why it's really important that we make sure that tenanted farmers and crofters have the ability to engage in all aspects of Tier 2, including on Tier 3, in terms of support. And part of that will be the transformation part, the capital that's required in order to invest, in order to put trees or hedges or whatever it is in. Coming on to the second question, which is a difficult one, in that we currently are limited to, you have to have a minimum of 3 hectares. I think a lot of the producers you're talking about may have less than 3 hectares. So it comes back to my plea at the start, which is the bill should potentially have definitions already embedded in it in terms of who are we supporting, why are we supporting them, and for what purpose. In terms of the local food markets, yes, there are important local food networks. I am slightly nervous when people talk about food security, because the true definition of food security is everybody has access to affordable food, and the affordable food element is often forgotten about it, and we substitute the word local in. So I was in Orkney recently, and they produce a large amount of beef. They have to put it all off the island for slaughter. So there is no local beef provision. Now, they're looking into those kind of things. So we are losing not only value-added opportunities, but the small producers. In the Western Isles, you can get support for polycrabs. In Shetland and Orkney, you can't get support for polycrabs to do local food producing. So there are opportunities that we're missing already. Whether you want to widen the suite of support measures, on the current things we're thinking, you have to ask yourself questions then about what type of support are they requiring. An area-based support on a third of a hectare isn't going to give you much. Are you going to do a whole farm plan? For you know, all of the new entry-level standards will have to be met if you're going to get that level of support. So it's fine for us to say these people deserve more support. It's how do you fit it in with what the government are thinking about in terms of the wider structures. And it may mean that they need the support through CLLD to embed the capacity to provide the grant aid to start up and support them in that journey, and actually providing food networks and better ideas of how food networks should operate at local and regional scale.
Jeremy, and then very briefly, Fiona.
Right, thanks. I was just going to come back mainly to the points around trees, possibly to urge a slight element of caution for reasons of timescale, but particularly business motivation and older attitudes that trees do not necessarily fit very well as a larger scale operation within the context of a commercial farming business. The investment is upfront and early. The return is decades and decades down the line. And while farmers do talk of thinking long term, they tend not really to mean that long term. Historically, it was more of an estate function to grow the timber. I mean, the 19th century, a major source of estate income. From then, much less now, but beginning to come back with the long-term markets for commercial timber. But that is, of course, something that's done at scale. So the ancillary, the shelter belts and so on, or the shielding of a slurry store to get the planning permission or whatever, those entirely ancillary, yes. But to think that, particularly for tenants, but actually for many owner-occupier farmers, that trees are a necessary part of their future, I think is to go down a false trail, because it doesn't fit a business model. There is no income in the near future for surrendering land to do that. The point that may surface, and it's a very important point that Steve made, is the pressure from the supply chain. And the supply chain is probably going to be at least as potent as anything we're talking about now, as it looks to deal with its, not to take control of its emissions, but to ensure that it can account properly for what other people who are supplying it are doing. And provided we can keep that line held, that would be an important line to have held, that we aren't alienating the carbon or the biodiversity to them, but we're merely saying we comply. That may drive some tree planting. It may drive some other things, but that's the price of having a business contract to sell the lamb or the beef or whatever it might be. And that's something where, again, the landlord, the tenant, or indeed just a straightforward owner-occupier commercial farmer are going to have to look at that as an absolute business proposition. Does it stack up, doesn't it, to get that business contract to sell the produce that they're there to farm for?
I've got Grant and then John, and I'll bring Fiona in at the end.
Yeah, I mean, I was just going to say, I'm not sure I agree entirely with that. In terms of one of the key things around this is trying to integrate different bits of land management together, rather than what we've traditionally do is we have farming in this one, we have woodland in this one, we have the next bit of land use in this one, and then we pay different amounts, and then we try and overcompensate to get one on top of the other. And so, I mean, one of the whole things around this is trying to get more integrated land management across that, and to actually see how you can integrate agricultural systems with woodland systems and such like, rather than seeing them as two separate things. So I don't think that's necessarily where we need to get to. And there is some bits in the bill. I mean, if you look at, I think it's in the one of, I think it's part four of this, the schedule at the back, is about integrated land management and assisting with integrated land management plans. I suppose the question around that is, well, what does that look like? What would you do? But it is about trying to bring these things all together to then look at that within a farm system. What is it you could do to integrate all these different income streams potentially together to have a better whole than what we currently do, which is we look at it through silos. And, you know, that's a key thing for this bill, in my mind, is trying to get back to that wider integrated land management on that, and not looking at them as just, I do woodland across there, I do farming across here, I do, you know, whatever it might be, to actually look at how we can make these things all work together.
There's always a place for trees in integrated land management, and you know, there's place for them. I think there's a huge amount of concern at the moment within young people in industry about the amount of tree planting that's going on in some areas. Obviously, huge corporations buying massive swathes of land just to plant them in trees in order to offset carbon. Obviously, pushing land prices through the roof. Going back to a point I made earlier about young people getting into the industry, you know, it's really putting a pressure on them. They don't have the kind of finances that they can compete with those kind of corporations, and then equally they can't get into the industry, and you know, that's a huge issue as well. So I think there maybe needs to be a bit of a consideration put in terms of, you know, the amount of tree planting that's done and also where it's done, and obviously, you know, about these corporations buying that amount of land and pushing obviously farmers that are wanting to produce food out of the market.
Fiona.
Very briefly, just picking up on Stephen's point there about food security, and I'm not here to bash the co-op, I absolutely want to say that. However, work was done around there in every rural and island community, and they redefined their stores in recent times, and if the footfall was at a certain level, they redefined them as convenience stores. This work has been published. Defined as convenience stores, which means they are not selling the full range of fruit and veg, because the argument is if you're here and you have a convenience store and you want a wider range of food, then you go a mile up the road. If you're on the Isle of Barra or you're wherever, you can't go a mile up the road. The co-op is it. And you're paying 28% more on average for the range of food, and it's more convenience food, more shelf space to alcohol, etc., etc. So we even have to look at, you know, I take Stephen's point, it's about affordable food, but frankly, the local supermarket, if you like, is not delivering on that per se, and the rural and island people are being shortchanged if that's their only offer and their choice is minimal and it's more expensive. So that's why local resilience is really important.
I'm going to try and bring this back to the bill that's in front of us. We have veered off into having a general discussion about food policy. So if we could try and restrict our comments to the bill that's in front of us and how it needs to be amended potentially to deliver. So Stephen, I think...
Yeah,
It was just coming back in on Grant's point, and I mean the design of the framework is to enable exactly what you're saying, is that the government will have ability to change the weightings associated with each of the conditional measures. And if we're not got enough woodlands on farms, you can increase the weighting to bring and make it incentivise it, so it becomes more of a, it becomes more worthwhile for the farmers to do that to get their tier two support. So the whole idea of the design of this is to enable exactly what you're saying within that. And I'll not go back on food security.
I'm going to move on to a slightly different angle from Rhoda Grant.
And because this bill is a framework bill, there's an awful lot of legislation that's coming from it. And with regard to this, there is regulations to change the Schedule 1, so to change who can get support under the bill. And those changes are made by a negative procedure, and I'm wondering if people think that's right. And for those who don't, a negative procedure is basically lodged in the Parliament, and if you want to move about against it, you have to vote it down in its entirety. You can't amend it, you can't change it. You really have to move against it. It's a kind of take it or leave it procedure. So I'm wondering if people think that that is adequate, and should we be looking to change that to provide greater scrutiny and maybe some consultation on any changes that's made?
Any? Jeremy?
Yes, just picking up on that. I suspect that the need may be to be nimbler in reaction to altering the scope of Schedule 1 as a first reaction to that. There clearly are a number of oddities about Schedule 1. Again, going back to an earlier theme, a lack of focus on supporting business approaches and productivity. But the number of products that are not sitting there in paragraph 3.3, pig meat, poultry, eggs, venison, herbs, and so on, that would need, I would think, quite rapid amendment at some point, at the point at which the government decided that those were worthy of possible objects, alongside cane sugar and beet sugar, which are, of course, grown enormously in certain parts of Scotland. There are aspects of this that are, I think, might well need nimbler responses as we find what's going wrong. So while strongly and leaning towards the super-affirmative role for the quasi-build of the Rural Support Plan, I suspect this is operational pragmatism.
Stephen.
I would tend to agree with Jeremy here, is that I don't think there's going to be wholesale changes, but given that we're encouraging farmers and crofters to be, and wider land managers to be more environmentally aware, there may be elements that we've not thought about that suddenly come into the mix that need to be rapidly put in because somebody said, well, what about my situation? I'm excluded from being included because you've not listed it in a schedule. So I think the government need flexibility here, and I don't think that they're talking. I don't think you can ever say that about governments, but you would hope that they're not going to have wholesale changes within this once you've passed this bill.
Just something to reflect on, and I'm not going to read this quote out and. Fool, because there's some unparliamentary language, but a former NFUS president suggests the bill gave the government power to do whatever they wanted, when they wanted, with whatever budget, on policy priorities as yet undecided or at least unpublished. Is that accurate? I'm looking at Stephen again because you're smiling.
Okay, so you're looking at me. On the face of it, you could suggest that because there is no budget allocation within the tiers, so there is no minimum spend. So if you could think to the EU legislative framework, and I'm using that because that's what we're currently based our model on, within the horizontal regulation that came out in 2014, there was it explained what the minimum spend for each of the schemes had to be. And it would have been useful in this bill to have a minimum spend in each of the tiers and an explanation of what schemes, types of schemes were to be supported and, therefore, maybe a minimum spend on those. And it doesn't have to be the actual budget, just a minimum spend. Because that then gives you, it kind of binds the government to that spend profile. And if they want to change that, they would have to come to Parliament. So on that front, I dare say there's some truth in that. On the enabling ministers to do what they like, I have already commented that there is an awful lot of powers that rest with ministers that have got limited scrutiny, or they may have opportunity for scrutiny. I don't know how fast and how many pieces of secondary legislation will come, but in the space of 2 or 3 years, you're going to have a lot, and things may get missed. That's perhaps where that risk is coming from.
Grant.
I suppose just put the alternative view, which is that putting figures into primary legislation does really then leave you with very little flexibility and things change. And I suppose if you look at how we used to do it, there was most of the figures for the previous things were then put through the Scottish Rural Development Programme, which set out exactly which schemes were going to be in place and how much money was going to be against each of those. And then money could be vied between those depending on changing priorities. So I think putting figures into primary legislation, I'm not sure that is a particularly good way to go. I do think that, I suppose we're going back to the rural support plan again, which is that's the place where you want to set out what your schemes are and what money you want to put against each of those, and that there should be an ability to change that as you go along, because, you know, in 3 or 4 years' time, there will be something comes up that's not been thought of just now that you need to do that. If you put it into this legislation, you're sort of very much tied without going through quite a big process to try and make any of those changes, which might need quite quick flexibility. So I think I have some sympathy with not being in the primary legislation, but I think the rural support plan again is the key bit around that.
Yes, I would agree with that completely. I think, again, in the spirit of keeping the bill a simple framework bill, you don't tie yourself down that way. But this really, really does put stress on the rural support plan and dealing with it in as rigorous a way, short of it being a bill, as you can. And yes, for platform rhetoric, that makes a point fairly acerbically, and hence the challenge and discussion we're having.
Before we move on, I want your thoughts on opportunities of how to use these powers to provide support and areas with alignment with new EU cap and when it's desirable and when it's not. Does there need to be some focus on powers that would allow the bill to react to that? Any thoughts on that? Jeremy.
You need powers to be able to react to any change in circumstances. When you look at the shocks we've seen in global supply chains, the movements in fertiliser prices, the shifting grain prices, geopolitical risk, the climate change abroad and here, again, the ability to be able to adapt and react within the framework seems critical. Rather, as with earlier answers, I wouldn't be terribly specific about what I wanted to have the freedom to react to. As somebody who drafts agreements periodically, Sod's Law says that the event you never foresaw is the one that happens within months of signing off an agreement. So I would be non-specific. It's flexibility for the world we're now in.
Ariane, would you like to come in on the supplementary?
Actually, I'm fine. I think that we answered it earlier.
Thank you. I think that we've exhausted that theme. We're going to move on to the final theme for today, which is looking at CPD, Continued Professional Development. A question from Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to just really open up the conversation on this and ask if the guests here today feel there is anything missing in detail in the bill in regards to this, or should there be any focus on any particular groups, such as tenants and young farmers, for example?
Yes, I mean, coming back to a point I made earlier about training and CPD, I think at the moment there is grants for some things. These are fairly limited, and it would be good to see these extended or more grants put forward. I think, you know, I'm not being sexist in any way, there's a Women in Agriculture grant for young women to get training for agriculture, but there's not the same grant for men. So I would like to see maybe a young person's agricultural grant put forward so that, you know, that training can be put out across the board. I know there's grants for all different things, you know, employers can apply for grants to put, you know, people through training, but I think you know, these are very limited. There's a lot of red tape involved. And I think going forward, if this could maybe be reviewed and see where more funding could be made available and maybe a wider range of training to fit, you know, more different skills and things that people are doing within their daily working lives, that would certainly come into that as well. And, yeah, I just think at the moment it's needing to be kind of the scopes needing to be far widened in terms of the training made available and the grants for that.
Thank you. Sarah.
Convener, in the RSE's response on this, there are 2 points. So, in principle, the RSE is supportive of these provisions. However, the CPD must be meaningful and provide genuine upskilling. It should be accessible as possible, particularly for those, given the current economic climate, because they could be precluded, particularly smaller and less profitable holdings seeking help, and that was mentioned earlier. Secondly, it would also be beneficial if support could be integrated across specific activities, rather than farmers needing to seek separate advice from different agencies depending on the type of land use.
Thank you. Fiona.
And say, given the demographic deficit we have across rural and island Scotland, only 17% of the population, and where are the young people in that? So just building on what John was saying, I think support for young people, particularly in the context of the just transition that we're going to be operating in, for them, even if they're inheriting land, but also to enable access to land, what they will do with it, then that kind of training to enable them to have that literacy of understanding of what is possible with the parcel of land that they will find themselves with. And of course, that will be very different in all corners of Scotland, but place-based, relevant training that will enable a younger demographic to work in that context, and support for that.
Thank you. I'm going to bring John and Douglas.
So, I mean, in terms of CPD, obviously, employers, you know, putting people through further training to what they maybe already have in terms of skills, or even people that are coming into the industry and reskilling. I think, you know, support for those employers that are, you know, expected to put those employees through training probably every year. You know, some kind of support for them as well would be good.
Yeah, I think as things develop further, there may be specific training needs for tenants. There's nothing springing to mind particularly at the moment. More generally on CPD, what we've really got to be careful of is heavy-handed, top-down CPD requirements which turn into tick boxes. That's what we definitely want to avoid. So the industry has to really be at the core of the designing any sort of CPD framework there. The other thing, you know, is making sure it's well designed and appropriate. I have been the recipient of some compulsory CPD as part of a government scheme in the past, and the experience wasn't completely positive, to put it mildly. So, you know, we need to be very careful there. And the other thing, just to flag, I mean, Dyslexia Scotland estimate something like 25% of Scotland's farmers suffer from dyslexia to one degree or another. I think that's quite often forgotten in terms of the design of CPD and written materials and everything else. So just all of that has to be brought into the mix to make sure we have an effective CPD. We would, STFA and majority of stakeholders within agriculture would support continued professional development. Farmers are very much professionals, and it's a glaring omission that there is, you know, there isn't that route to develop themselves. That's not always available, but you know, let's take some time to design the system and look at the delivery mechanisms as well, because the big pressure for a lot of our members is time. Who can afford the time? If you're a one-person operation, taking time out to attend a training course is a real challenge. Now we've got the technology to do better than that now, so just again a plea.
I've got a number of stakeholders who want to come in. Can I add another question onto the question we've already had? There's 10 potential requirements which may or must be undertaken. So there's a bit of a stick here as well. Should we have any concerns that CPD, which should be something that most managers or people involved in the industry should look as a positive to their business, should we have any concerns about the provisions which require, must, or may undertake activities? And is it a bit of a sledgehammer to crack a nut? Any concerns on that? I'm going to bring in Rob, Sarah, and then Stephen.
Thanks. think CPD is very necessary given how much we're asking of farmers, land managers and communities. They're going to need to change a lot. They're going to need a lot of support to do that. I suppose one plea I would make is to think about how support to this particular group interlinks with wider support, and I'm thinking around things like innovation and entrepreneurship, around new business development and the like. And when we're looking at communities, one big advantage of the LEADER programme certainly was that ability to help communities to engage domestically but also internationally and understand what others were doing, so pick up new thoughts and ideas. And I think that's a really important element going forward, particularly again given the changes that we're asking. There will be people out there who are doing stuff that is relevant to our communities, to our farmers and crofters, so that needs to be built into this. A good example of that is the work that we were recently involved in with the OECD looking at rural innovation, and a very strong component around social innovation, so how communities and community organisations respond to challenges and opportunities. Now, Scotland's a leader in that, but just because we're a leader, there's still an awful lot we can learn from others about that. So I think that needs to be a strong component of whatever goes forward here.
Mine is on wider rural, so if you want to save me till later, because this is all on agriculture CPD.
So. We can open up to rural or agriculture.
Okay. Yeah. So in section 5 CLLD to date, informal CPD or knowledge exchange has been absolutely critical, and it's been a hallmark of LEADER, certainly the national exchange and indeed international exchange, for ensuring efficiencies in resource use of LEADER money so that the wheel isn't constantly being reinvented about how things are done effectively. So I would encourage consideration of that KE and informal CPD being integrated into the next version, because if not, things become hyper-local and there is no awareness being taken of how things are done elsewhere in Scotland, but also internationally in comparative context.
Okay. Good, Stephen, and then Jeremy.
Yeah, I suppose on CPD, there's a few things that really need to be considered. Is the again, doing events, I notice that quite often, if you're through the day, it's full-time farmers that appear. The part-time farmer who's off-farm working doesn't have the opportunity. So there are real risks in here that you alienate a certain proportion of the industry. And the other one is there's provisions for charging for CBD courses and things. That then is an additional compliance cost, because you'll also have farmer time or crofter time plus travel time. And that again becomes this risk with the smallest producers, that they see this as a hurdle too far for them, or an older population that think, I'm going to have to do CPD and I'm sitting here in my 70s. Somebody's going to teach me how to suck my eggs. I don't really know how this plays out at that level, but these are considerations that have to be you have to take into account if you're going to legislate for it, if it's going to be compulsory and if it's voluntary. So where the courses are taking place, Doug's already mentioned dyslexia. We also have, if it's online, then there are people that don't engage online, they don't have the skills. We have not spots still in Scotland in terms of digital connectivity. So these are all really important factors. And the other one being, whoever's delivering CPD should be accredited, and the courses should be accredited to make sure that the advice that they're giving is pertinent to the industry and is actually up to a certain standard.
Thank you. Theona. I've got a number of members indicate, so we're going to bring the members in at the end. So I beg your pardon, Jeremy, and then Theona.
I think the issue here in part is the human factor once you come to the word require. I'm looking at this a little in the context of the Welsh Universal Actions, which include some requirements for CPD, and the inevitable question that comes out of that when you look at the range of universal actions required, potentially analogous, not necessarily, but potentially to the conditionality of Tier 2, is how much non-compliance is acceptable. Because you hit this thrust, there will be human reasons why people have not been able to attend, I mean, illness or whatever it is, but actually make, coming back to a phrase of Doug's earlier on, this becomes tick box. People will respond to need, necessity, to, you know, they will, when something's important and they will want it and they see benefit in it, when it's interesting and attractive and indeed sociable, they will come to it. Simply requiring that you do six sessions across four of 12 topics in a year, remote or in line, and nobody even offers you a pint at the end of it, is going to not achieve anything. And always with these things, and, you know, we do lots of in-house training and so on for our people, is getting engagement. You can get, particularly remotely, you can get people to attend. The blank cameras, how you get them to engage, to answer, to be involved, so that it's actually effective. And I think almost you can achieve more by requiring less. But it's ensuring that you strike where the iron is warmest.
Thank you. Fiona.
Just quickly, and just building on what Stephen was saying as well, I think there should be something within this that farmers and crofters should not always have to be learning something new. We haven't always got that right in the past, have we? So therefore, I think if there's something around recognition of skills, as long as they align with that which we are asking, but recognising that actually some are already doing that and the answers are already available in some cases. And then just building on what John was saying, the cost and the time constraints of attending training and so on, I don't know whether it's out of the remit of this group, but I mean, I think we should look at the role of schools. We did write and commission the crofting course. I can see how that has impacted, you know, with parity of esteem of qualifications. It has impacted those active in crofting and taking part in the roles of agricultural committees and so on in our community. So the earlier you have that place-based, locally relevant education that shows young people that there are opportunities where they are and this is the support you can access, and they have that accreditation that gives them parity of esteem, even if they go somewhere else, they know that they can operate where they are. So that's kind of stepping in before they go to work. Maybe consider that.
Thank you. Okay, we've actually run out of time, but I'm conscious we've got three members who want to ask a supplementary. So I'm going to ask them all to ask their supplementary, and hopefully the witnesses can then address the questions altogether just to get through them. So I'll ask Ariane, Jim, and then Rachel to ask their short supplementaries, please.
Thanks, Convener. So this is kind of touching on what Sarah was talking about, kind of broader beyond kind of CBDs for farming specific, but I've become aware of the mental health challenges for people, farmers, but also people living and working rurally. And I just wonder if the government needs to be aware that the scope needs to be broader, and that we need to really, given that we're in a just transition and people are going to have to be learning a lot, that the mental health part is addressed.
Thank you. Jim.
Yeah, this one's probably very specifically Stephen. You touched on the 75-year-old that we're going to try and teach to suck eggs. We had a grandfather's rights type process for sprayers. Is there a need to find some accommodation for that type of scheme as we go forward with this?
Well, it's really to Rob, and obviously I live in an area, it's represented by SOCI, South Scotland Enterprise. I just wondered if you had any expectation that High or SOCI would be offering advice to farmers, and therefore I just wondered whether it would be right that not only farmers have CPD but others that are giving advice.
Okay, I'm going to go to Stephen first to answer those three questions. I'll go to Rob and then and open it up.
Didn't realise I was answering all three, but I'll give it a go.
Answer if you feel that you've got a position you want to...
So on the SOCI High thing, then advice is one thing, and requiring CPD, but I suppose from the government's perspective is that they're spending quite a lot of money in this sector, and making sure that that's targeted and actually delivering on the outcomes that they want is where the CPD element comes into it. And then just when Jim was asking me that question, I kind of thought, and I've just written down here, is grandfather rights in certain circumstances, but you might actually require still require CPD on vet med, because I've seen how some of the vet meds are put, veterinary medicines are used. And we've got new things coming down the track on things like methane inhibitors. So should we require people that are going to use methane inhibitors to have some kind of competence in that? So it will be a bit of everything, I think, in some of this.
And Ariane's point on mental health?
Well, yes, we all need to... I think there's a... When you speak to farmers and wider rural people that are engaged in land management, there's an awful lot of mental health concerns just now, in that they see, just this is my take on what they're telling me, is that that they're seeing an awful lot of things coming down the track in terms of legislation control over what they've done. And remember what we said earlier on, is that we are dealing with a path dependent sector. The where they are now is a legacy of all the support and regulations that we've put in the past. It's not by chance they're here. It's because we've directed them, or governments have directed them. So suddenly putting up a barrier and saying, you've done it all wrong and we're going to change everything, there's a big fear factor out there just now.
OK, thank you. And Rob?
Yeah, I think there's probably a lot of CPD that farms and crofters need or have that High and Sales 8 are absolutely not the right organisation to be providing that. I think where we do have a role is in those aspects that I mentioned earlier around things like innovation, entrepreneurship. So if individuals are looking to start new businesses, there's ourselves, there's Business Gateway, and it's, I suppose, it's that integration between wider business support and support specifically for this cohort of people, and making sure that that's better interlinked is really important. And I guess if we look at communities, then it's around helping communities to figure out how they develop their community, potentially how they secure and manage assets, which can be quite big and quite complex and take up a lot of community time and a lot of community effort. So how can they build the capacity and the capability to do that? Some communities are really good at it. Other communities really struggle at it. So how do we try to level that up? And it's also about giving them the opportunity to learn from others, because there aren't that many really, really new ideas out there, but there's a lot of ideas that are new to us or new to the community that other people are doing. So it's ensuring that communication and that engagement.
Thank you. I've got Sarah and then John.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Ariane, on the question around rural mental health. Scottish Government funds through its Rural and Mental Health Directorates the National Rural Mental Health Forum. The forum works beyond and within farming communities and has over 230 organisational members. Key areas that it focuses on are exchanging knowledge and skills around how to address mental health across rural Scotland, and informing policy and reducing stigma so that mental health becomes everyone's business. It does engage with FarmStrong as well, which is a newly emerging support process and network specifically for the farming community. And I'd be happy to engage with you or any other committee members around the National Rural Mental Health Forum. And we, as the RSE, attend the forum as well and can give you further information on that. But agree it's a specific area needing growing support in Scotland.
Thank you. John and then Douglas.
Yeah, I think going to Ariane's question around mental health, I think from the young farmer's perspective, there's been a lot of stories in the last few years about young people taking their lives in rural communities, and that's something that hits home hugely with young farmers. We work very closely, obviously. Sarah mentioned FarmStrong, and you know, we work closely with RSABI as well. And we've just this year, our Development and Wellbeing Committee piloted an app for young people, which will hopefully be coming to the fore in the next few weeks, just you know, around mental health and young people in the rural community, and it's something that we take very seriously through our Are You OK campaign as well, and it's something that, you know, has hit us quite hard, but we are very passionate about looking after mental health. And I think, you know, in terms of, you were asking about if the scope can be widened, I think, you know, seeing how far this issue has came in the conversation in the last 10 years, I think, you know, the scope can always be widened. I think, you know, there's so much great work has been done already, but there's so much we can still do, and certainly the young farmers are very focused on that.
Thank you. Douglas.
Yeah, just come back on mental health. Wearing a different hat, I do a bit of work for RSCBI, and their helpline just now, it might be wrong to describe it as a spike in calls to that helpline, but they're certainly increasing. And a lot of that's driven because of the uncertainty and the vacuum that we're operating in. There is potential for that to get even worse as information starts to disseminate. So it's just to make that plea that this is a very important aspect of the introduction of new policy. I think comms is absolutely essential to that, getting the communication right, having the soft skills to get these messages conveyed to people in such a way that it doesn't exacerbate any mental health issues they should have. So it's critically important, and it's something that is, you know, unfortunately, we don't talk about suicide in our industry nearly enough, but it's something that is absolutely, at the front of a lot of people's minds. So we do need to be able to talk about it. On a particularly a lighter note, Jim, your grandfather writes, I think on the average age of farmers, you have to be quite careful where you would pitch that, because if we're looking at near enough 60, they're certainly old enough to be grandfathers.
Thank you. And Jim's got a final comment.
Yeah, it was just a question to yourself, Sarah. You mentioned Farmstrong, but the other lads have mentioned RSABI. Do Farmstrong do something different to RSABI, or are they overlapping? Are they duplicating? What is the difference?
So the effort is all integrated. So RSABI is part of the forum. Forum's engaging with Farmstrong. Farmstrong is a new initiative with new employees just starting out just now. So I can get back to members on those specifics. But it's all integrated, and the forum is an umbrella that integrates all the different efforts. And if I could just say one very quick word, one of the strengths of it is that there are many rural-like organisations working in rural Scotland but don't have mental health expertise necessarily, and there are mental health organisations in rural Scotland that don't necessarily have the rural networks, and so it's bringing those two together. So yes, there's an integration, and conversations were indeed happening out at Ingolston yesterday with Farmstrong, the Forum, RSABI, so they're linked together.
Thank you. And the final word, Stephen.
Yeah, I always like to get a final word. On Farmstrong, it's more of a proactive approach, where farmers' mental and physical well-being is one of their key objectives, rather than a RSABI, which is more of a reactive approach. And it's trying to better integrate. I think that's where they're trying to do, is integrate it across the whole thing, so that wherever you are on that chain, you've got support.
Thank you. And on that note, that completes our witness session for this morning. We are on a tight timetable, so I'm going to suspend the meeting until 12:15 to allow a change of our witnesses. Thank you.
Our third item of business is consideration of the legislative consent memorandum for the Animal Welfare Livestock Exports Bill. And I welcome Gillian Martin, the Minister for Energy and the Environment, and our supporting officials, Andrew Voss, the Veterinary Head of Animal Welfare, and Grant McLarty, the Solicitor from Scottish Government. And I invite the Minister to make an opening statement.
Convener, I welcome the opportunity today to discuss this legislative consent memorandum to give effect in Scotland to the Animal Welfare Livestock Exports Bill. Excuse me. The bill will make provision about the welfare of animals, principally by prohibiting the export of livestock from Great Britain for slaughter and fattening for slaughter. The bill also repeals outdated legislation regarding export of horses. The Scottish Government proposes legislative consent to this bill insofar as it makes provision within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament. And the Scottish Government committed to work with the other administrations to seek the end of unnecessary long-distance transport of animals for fattening or slaughter outside the UK. We are a little bit disappointed that there's not been key commitments previously made to improve protection for wildlife and animals, and that the promised Animal Welfare Kept Animals Bill, which was delivered in this area with a package of joint welfare measures across the GB. However, this standalone bill provides an opportunity to have consistent control over such exports, and to assist enforcement agencies to ensure that such unnecessary movements no longer take place. These measures have been called for by many of the main animal welfare organisations, and the Scottish Government very much supports their introduction. The Scottish Government recognises, however, for the measures in this bill to be successful, they should be introduced consistently across Great Britain. Consistent legislative measures across GB will also assist when it comes to interpretation and enforcement of new controls, and a coordinated GB-wide approach to tackling issues covered by the Animal Welfare Livestock Exports Bill is widely supported and welcomed by many key stakeholders. Allowing the UK Parliament to legislate for all GB administrations in this area is the most timely, efficient and effective way to achieve these important changes. However, I need to be absolutely clear that we will not implement anything that potentially jeopardises the livelihoods of our farmers and crofters who rely on being able to move livestock between their islands and the mainland. Should any attempt be made to introduce any restrictions like this in this GB-wide bill, the Scottish Government would withdraw its consent and bring forward our own legislation to limit the extent of application to export, and I'm sure the committee would wish to support that approach. However, I am assured that our position is understood and accepted by DEFRA, and I do not anticipate there have been any issues in the passage of this bill, nor any need to withdraw our consent, and I'm happy to take any questions you might have, Convener.
Thank you, Minister. Any questions? Rachel Hamilton.
Convener, just to clarify, animal welfare is devolved, so could you at any point make a different approach to this?
Okay. So we opted not to do that in this case. We think it makes sense to have a GB-wide approach, and we're content with all the everything that's in the bill as it stands, and it pretty much replicates what we would have wanted anyway. But we do have the power, if we want to take our own statutory instrument forward, to do a separate scheme. We just don't see the reason, any reason to do that at this stage.
Thank you.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks. Can I just get a clarification? You mentioned the export of animals from Scottish islands to mainland Scotland. Mm-hmm. Can I just get clarification on what kind of discussions you've had with DEFRA, how clear they are about that point that you made?
Well, my officials have been... this has actually been something that even the Cabinet Secretary had been leading on, because it was actually in the Kept Animals Bill, which was the bill that fell. There was quite exactly the same provisions in this bill within that. So all this has been a long-standing discussion that's been made. Effectively, what they've done with the Kept Animals Bill is they've taken this part of it and then put it into a new bill. So Mary Goujon had extensive, and her officials had extensive discussions about those particular issues that you raise, and we are confident that they've been heard, and there's no provision at the moment to have anything that would mean that the export or the travel of animals from island producers to the mainland will be impacted at all by this bill.
Thank you.
I suppose my question is on that. We have given me some assurances. So the direction of this bill, when it comes to animal exports, the welfare concerns are more to do about the inability for those who are exporting to have any control over the animal welfare conditions that those animals might find themselves in. It's not about the animal welfare concerns relating to animals on ferries, and in which case we should have no concerns that future legislation might have an impact on those animals that are moved from Orkney or Shetland.
You're exactly right, Convener. It's about we cannot be sure that where animals are exported to for fattening and slaughter would have the same conditions that we would expect.
Jim Fairley.
Very minor point that's just cropped into my mind. I apologise. I presume it's fattening and slaughter, so therefore high-value breeding animals going across the likes of Northern Ireland will not be impacted by this legislation?
So it's not, it does not cover breeding. So breeding, export for breeding is still allowed. Of course, if they're going across the EU and they're being bred and then they actually stay there, then obviously they could be a future point in their life, they could be slaughtered. But for the express purposes of breeding, no, it doesn't affect them. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. Minister, we have no further questions, so thank you and your officials for attending this morning. The committee will review the evidence we've just heard and discuss our report on the LCM in our next agenda item. And that concludes our business in public, and I move the meeting into private session.